So there is greater resilience, but the process is an incremental one, which will take some time to be completed.
Thank you. That ends topical questions. The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Food Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that is SP Bill 48A, the marshalled list, that is SP Bill 48AML, the groupings, that is SP Bill 48AG. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon. The period of voting for the first division will be 30 seconds. Thereafter, I will allow a voting period of 1 minute for the first division after debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments.
I call start with Group 1, improving the extent to which public have diets conducive to good health, and I call Amendment 4 in the name of Dr Richard Simpson, grouped with Amendment 10, and I ask Dr Richard Simpson to move Amendment 4 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This amendment is to clarify the objectives for improvement in the diet for public health purposes to specify content, including calories. Obesity, diabetes and heart disease and stroke remain amongst the greatest challenges we face, and if we're serious about improving the health of the public, our independent food agency will need to play a vigorous leading role. The elements which require to be addressed by our newly independent agency include salt, saturated fats, trans fats, sugar and calories. The FSA has done excellent work in terms of content in some areas. For example, the maximum values such as trans fats, saturated fats, sodium and sugar, as well as the minimum protein specifications. These were all put into the School Meals Programme 2004 regulations. And on the 19th of June 2013, the Food Standards Agency in Scotland launched a new front of pack nutrition labelling scheme, which is very welcome, and I'm delighted that we now have traffic lights as a system. Indeed, over the years, the Food Standards Agency has done an excellent job in many areas, including reducing the amount of salt in our diet. But salt consumption remains high at 8.1 to 8.8 grams per day, and it's important we achieve a level of 6 grams per day across the adult population. On trans fats, again, there's been good progress, but the restriction of all trans fats, which are not naturally occurring, would have been achieved had my private member's bill received support in the last Parliament. Too many fast foods still have these dangerous fats present. On saturated fats and sugars, there have been progress too, but one area which has yet to be tackled as vigorously is that of calories. And Amendment 10, then, is to specify that the agency has the power to bring in a national scheme on calorie values. At present, the bill does refer to a hygiene scheme, which is welcome, and there is a voluntary progress here, for example, with labelling recently by Sainsbury's of their wine calorie values in their wines. But colleagues, over 20 years ago I visited the Mayo Clinic in the USA and they were showing calorie and saturated fat levels on the menus. So we need a step change in this area. It's welcome that the Parliament also has been putting calorie values on its menus, which I hope some members have paid attention to. As the bill is currently written, Clause 2, Subsection 2 makes clear the risks referred to in Clause 2, Subsection 1A, and relates to the way in which food is produced and supplied. But my amendment makes it clearer in respect of the new objective in Clause 2, Subsection 1B, that the content of food beyond safety and integrity, and including its calorie content and its advertising and its promotion, are now defined objectives. Currently, we have warning signs on tobacco, we have traffic lights for living and food, but we need to ensure that in its advertising and in its promotion across the industry, they are held to strict conditions to ensure that obesity and public health issues are made clear and that the public are fully informed. I move amendments in my name, numbers 4 and 10.
Many thanks. No other member has asked to speak in this group, so I now call the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all agree that the content of food and the issues concerning its calorific value are important in the question of a healthy diet. I'm therefore grateful to Dr. Simpson for raising these issues. I know how passionately he promotes them. But while the amendments in this group are perhaps well intended, I do not believe they are necessary or will improve the bill. Amendment 4 could cause confusion by inserting what is essentially a function, like those in Section 3 of the bill, into the objectives of FSS. This could be confusing in that it would give this particular function undue emphasis to the detriment of all the other important functions FSS must perform. Indeed, the functions in Section 3 already include functions of giving advice and information and informing the public about matters which affect their capacity to make informed decisions about food. So if content and calories are matters of concern to consumers, giving information about these will already be part of what the body does. There is no need for this new amendment. But more importantly, calorific values and food content are not the only factors which bear on a healthy diet. Referring them expressly in the bill creates a risk of an undue focus on these factors at the expense of considering issues of food health in the round. Further, the amendment suggests that FSS will have a role to set standards in respect of calories, content, advertising and promotion. This will not be the case. Food information and, to some extent, nutrition are matters regulated at EU level. Setting the standards for industry based on evidence and advice from bodies such as FSS is a role for the EU and the Scottish Government, not FSS. Amendment 10 is similarly well intended, but I consider it would not be right to add it to the bill at this time. This amendment would add a relatively significant new enabling power to the bill in circumstances in which neither the Health and Sport Committee nor the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has had an opportunity to input to it. Subject to advice from FSS and others, the Scottish Ministers may well in due course support the idea of a public consultation on a mandatory scheme requiring food businesses to display nutrition values. That is what we did for the prospective mandatory scheme on displaying hygiene information as contained in the bill. However, more work would be required on whether displaying calorie values or wider nutritional information is effective in helping consumers have healthy diets before we go ahead with this idea. I'd like to hear from consumers about whether they would prefer to see a scheme focus on sugar or on salt first, for instance. However, the most significant reason for not accepting this amendment as it stands is the impact on small businesses and local authorities. Each time mandatory schemes on calorie values, sugar and salt content, etc., are considered, the impact on small producers is highlighted. We can't ignore this. We have to be proportionate in our approach and balance the benefits with the impacts. Larger food producers and retailers, for example, will arguably have more resource to dedicate to researching and preparing the display of calorie values. Indeed, many larger organisations, as Dr. Simpson himself highlighted, have a policy on this already. However, smaller businesses such as caterers or restaurants will find this extremely expensive to comply with. Further, the additional burden on local authority officers who would have to check all these additional displays would be significant. We need to take a proportionate and partnership approach to any scheme that would put undue pressure on our businesses and on our local authority colleagues. For these reasons, I believe Amendment 10 is premature. It requires more work and consultation to work up proposals for a scheme before legislation could be considered. These amendments are well intended, but existing legislation can be used to deliver the same outcome, and the amendments as they stand would be disproportionate and have not been consulted upon. I would therefore invite the Parliament not to accept Amendments 4 and 10.
Many thanks. Could you wind up, Dr Simpson, and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw?
First of all, can I thank the Minister for some of the words that she has given, and I understand the reasons for the Government saying that this is not at this time necessary. It is, of course, possible to introduce clauses and then not activate them until you're ready to do so. And giving an example, the social responsibility levy on alcohol, which has still not been regulated on, but has actually was passed in this Parliament 5 years ago. So actually the timing would be a matter for the Government to decide as being appropriate. But I welcome the fact that the Minister actually agrees with me that calories, along with the other things which I listed, are all important. These amendments would have actually given a message to industry that these are in things that we intend to tackle in a vigorous way and that they should prepare for that. However, in the light of the Minister's words, I am prepared to withdraw or not move, whatever the appropriate thing that the presiding officer will advise me on.
Thank you, Dr Simpson. You're seeking to withdraw. Is that acceptable? I have no one suggesting otherwise. Thank you very much. In which case, we now move to Group 2, matters in relation to which Food Standards Scotland must keep the public informed. And I call Amendment 5 in the name of Dr Richard Simpson in a group on its own. And I ask Dr Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 5, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've raised this amendment because I do feel strongly that the word significantly is an unnecessary restriction on the agency in protecting the public. The objectives in the previous clause talk about being proportionate and acting in a manner which fulfills their objective. So it is up to the agency how they deal with it. But to actually say that they've got to define significantly, I think, is difficult. I don't fully understand the legal definition of what constitutes significant. For example, if something affects a very small minority, is that effect significant? It is for that minority, but in global terms, for the population in Scotland as a whole, it is not. It may be regarded as quite insubstantial. But when added to other small effects, a number of small effects collectively can also become substantial. And therefore, this word significant is one which, quite frankly, sticks in my craw. I did try to remove it at stage. We did try to get it removed at stage one, but there was some debate as to whether I was allowed to intervene at that time. So I'm really rising to make the point and to see how the Minister defines the word significantly, because depending on how she does define it, I will either press or withdraw. At the present moment, I move this amendment.
Any thanks, Minister?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 5, as Dr Simpson said, was lodged at stage 2. It was debated and then withdrawn following a division. As my predecessor said at stage 2, we understand the intention of the proposal to remove the word significantly here. It is important that Food Standards Scotland acts in a wide range of interests as are important to consumer. That's the intended objective. However, the practical effect of this seemingly small change would be disproportionate. It would mean that the body could have to turn its attention to a hugely wide range of concerns, significant or not. That could risk its losing its focus on the most important matters. I think the word significantly is vital here to make clear that although Food Standards Scotland will be concerned with all matters of interest to consumers, it cannot lose focus on those matters which impact most on consumers. For that reason, I would invite Parliament not to accept Amendment 5.
Thank you. Dr Simpson, could you respond and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw?
I accept the definition of significantly that the Minister has now put on the record, and that is that if it affects people in the way I've described, that is a small minority, but they are affected substantially, that action would be taken because that would be a priority for them. But that generally, of course, the Food Standards Agency should be looking at matters of greater importance. It will be up to them to prioritise it. But on the basis of the Minister's words, I am prepared not to move or not to press this amendment.
Dr Simpson seeks to withdraw. Does any member object to that? No, in which case we move on to Group 3, Membership of Food Standards Scotland. And I call Amendment 6 in the name of Dr Richard Simpson, grouped with Amendment 7. I ask Dr Simpson to move Amendment 6 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I appreciate that we had a good debate on this in Stage 2 in the Health Committee when an amendment was moved by Aileen MacLeod to change the minimum to 5, which was not accepted by the Minister. This increase was supported in evidence by such disparate groups as Quality Meat Scotland, on the one hand, and Which, on the other hand. So let us look at the proposed minimum, which is 3 plus the Chair. If 2 members are absent, this could reduce the Board to 2. And I'm not speaking entirely theoretically, as I've looked at a number of other NGOs where the absence of 2 members is not actually unusual. I don't believe a Board could or should function without at least 3 members present, and I therefore proposed a modest increase to 4 plus the Chair in the hope that at least 3 will be present on every occasion. If we look at other evidence which suggested that there should be an employee director, and in addition to that there should be gender balance, and that there should be a strong consumer interest, then I think this modest increase is appropriate. One further item. The Minister in this response at Stage 2 said that they would try to keep this Board at a higher level than 3. But if they're going to do that, then I suggest that they should have a higher minimum as well, not least because this would actually ensure that matters are dealt with in an appropriate way. And finally, there is the point that the Minister also said that this Board was smaller because the functions of this new agency were smaller. Minister, this Board's powers and the things it has to do are expanding significantly. Matters of public safety on food have come to the fore in the last year since this bill was beginning to be prepared, and I would suggest that we need a Board that is strong enough to be effective, and on that basis I wish to move this amendment. On Amendment 7, this amendment has a similar intent to that of my previous amendment. It is intended, however, to be helpful to the Government, because if Amendment 5 were rejected by the Government, sorry, Amendment 6 were rejected by the Government, this would make the Amendment 7 more important. What it does is allows the Minister to ensure that where members are disqualified through any new office listed under the preceding clause, she or he will have the power to grant an extension in order to ensure that the Board is functional. I move these 2 amendments in my name.
Many thanks. Nanette Milne.
Extremely briefly, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just to say, a number of significant witnesses did actually seek for a larger minimum number on the boards. I think Richard Simpson has given a number of very good reasons as to why his amendment should be approved, and I'm happy to support that.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As Dr. Richard Simpson said, a very similar amendment to Amendment 6 was moved and withdrawn without objection at Stage 2. The Health and Sport Committee also considered the number of members at Stage 1 and accepted that the number set out in the bill is a minimum only. Ministers have given assurance to the committee on this. I will shortly be announcing the appointment of 7 further members to add to the appointment of Ross Finney as Chair Designate announced last month. I hope this is clear evidence of Government's commitment to run Food Standards Scotland with its full complement of 8. 7 members and the Chair as the norm. The minimum number in the bill, 3 members plus the Chair, has to be low enough to allow flexibility during reappointment rounds or in case of emergencies. This number and lower numbers already work for other similar sized bodies. The Scottish Charities Regulator has a minimum number of 4, including the Chair, and the Scottish Housing Regulator has a minimum number of 3, including the Chair. This has not caused difficulty for them. The Government sees no reason to reconsider this minimum number. On Amendment 7, I believe that this amendment is unnecessary and impractical. It is unnecessary in that it is extremely unlikely that a member would take up any of the public offices or employment listed in Section 7(1) without being in a position to give ministers some notice. This would usually allow ministers sufficient time to make arrangements to protect the ability of FSS to carry out its functions. Remaining as a member of FSS while taking up many of the listed posts would lead to immediate conflicts of interest. In fact, taking up many of the posts, parliamentary and council posts in particular, would mean having to declare an interest and then taking no part in FSS decisions in any case. There is nothing ministers can do to set that aside. This makes the arrangement suggested by Amendment 7 wholly redundant. So therefore, I invite the Parliament not to accept Amendments 6 and 7.
Many thanks, and ask Dr Simpson to wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw, please.
If I may, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'll deal with the amendments summing up in reverse order. On Amendment 7, I think the one thing the Minister said, which I don't agree with, is that a member of the Scottish Parliament or a member of the House of Commons, if you're elected, you go straight into business. You're not able to give a lot of notice, and therefore, you know, it is problematic, because if there's an immediate disqualification, then they would have to leave the board immediately, so no notice would be given. However, this was intended to be helpful to the Minister and future governments, including, one hopes, a Labour government. But if the Minister chooses to reject that, I see the Minister smiling, then I'm happy not to move Amendment 7. This is not the case, however, with Amendment 6. I do believe that the arguments that have been put forward are not sufficient. I think that the other NGOs or agencies that she's quoted have quite different functions. This new body is now going to be dealing with the FSA in England, the Board of Trade in England, the European FSA. It is going to be dealing with all our public safety matters on nutrition, meat inspection. The list of functions is huge, and the required experience across that area is going to be massive. I very much welcome the appointment of Ross Finney as the prospective chair of this, providing the bill is passed. He is a man of great experience. However, I do believe that that the minimum number of 4 is a not unreasonable thing to have requested in the government, and I am disappointed that it has been rejected, or it is proposed to be rejected by the government. I will move this amendment in my name.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament is not agreed, so there will be a division. But as this is the first division of this stage this afternoon, Parliament is now suspended for 5 minutes. Order. We'll now proceed with the division on amendment number 6. This is a 30-second division and members should cast their votes now, please. Order. The result of the vote on amendment number 6 is yes 45, no 62. There are no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now call amendment 7 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, already debated with amendment 6, and I ask Dr. Simpson to move or not to move.
Not move.
Many thanks, in which case we now move to group 4, annual and other reports, and I call amendment 8 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, grouped with Amendment 9, and I ask Dr. Simpson to move Amendment 8 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We did have a debate on this area of concern at Stage 2 about online publishing, and the view of the Minister was that the time was not right to exclusively publish all reports only online, because this would exclude some who did not have access to digital applications. Now, whilst I would dispute this insofar as those members of the public who do not have personal access to the internet do have access through their public libraries. And my original amendment, I do accept, was probably ahead of its time. So I hope the Minister may now be more willing to accept this revised set of amendments about the cost of printing, which should be published as an incentive to the agency to reduce its costs over time. Amendment 9 requires that reports laid before Parliament should only be online, as the MSP should all be reasonably digital savvy by now. Of course, these reports online can also be in formats for those with a visual disability or other disabilities. So I hope the Minister will now accept these revised amendments as a more timely approach to the matter of trying to reduce the amount of paper that floats around the system, costs a fortune and destroys trees.
Many thanks. I call the Minister.
Presiding Officer, if the intention of Amendment 8 is indeed to help keep a handle on the costs associated with printing reports and the environmental impact of that, then I'm happy to offer my assurance that this is something ministers are always keen to encourage. However, this specific amendment is unclear and unnecessary. It is not clear whether the option to lay a statement of costs that Food Standards Scotland would have would concern the costs associated with printing copies to be laid in Parliament or all copies printed. This is confusing. I believe this amendment is also unnecessary. It is not something that any other public body is being asked to do. The statutory duties of best value require public bodies to demonstrate and be audited on how they operate efficiently and economically. In any case, I will be happy to emphasise the need to consider printing costs and impacts in the FSS statement of performance of functions for avoidance of any doubt over our commitments. Amendment 9 is unnecessary too, Presiding Officer. Ministers have already pointed out at Stage 2, when a very similar amendment was lodged, that the way documents are laid in Parliament is already well regulated. This amendment is also vague in that it is not clear whether normally would mean that FSS would have to have good reason in a given case to lodge a physical document, or instead that it could choose in any case to lodge a physical document provided it followed a general practice of lodging electronically. I therefore ask the Parliament not to accept Amendments 8 or 9.
Many thanks, Dr. Simpson.
Can I thank the Minister for her response, and I accept that from what she's saying that the Government will seek to reduce the number of paper reports that come in as far as possible, and will hopefully the Parliament may look at the regulations regarding the submission of reports. The one thing that I would not accept in what she's saying is that the question of whether all reports or some reports, this was left for the FSA to make a decision. There may be occasions on which a paper report was appropriate, and it was to give them some wriggle room. But otherwise, I will not press these amendments with the permission of the Parliament.
Dr. Simpson seeks to withdraw Amendment 8. Does any member object to that?
No.
In which case, I have to call Amendment 9 in the name of Dr. Simpson. It's already debated with Amendment 8, and ask Dr. Simpson to move or not move.
Not moved.
Many thanks. That then takes us to Group 5, minor and technical amendments. And I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 2 and 3. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 1 and speak to all of the amendments in the group, please.
Presiding Officer, the amendments in this group are minor, either updating the draft or providing more clarity. I believe these amendments will improve the clarity and consistency of the Bill's provision. Amendment 1 corrects a minor oversight in the Bill as introduced. The word subsection is required here for consistency with neighbouring subsections and to give full effect to Section 32. Amendment 2 provides clarity on the circumstances in which regulations made in connection with administrative sanctions can allow for discharging criminal liability where someone has been served with both a fixed penalty notice and a compliance notice. This section, added at Stage 2, was intended to cover that situation. However, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee published its report on the bill as amended at Stage 2 last Wednesday. Its report recommended that we make the further change this amendment makes. Amendment 3 updates the list of acts which would be modified by the enactment of the bill. It is now clear that the Agricultural Statistics Act 1979 does not extend to Scotland and so requires no modification. The amendment here removes that from the schedule accordingly. Presiding Officer, I move Amendment 1.
Many thanks. I had a request to speak from Nigel Dawn. Is that correct?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just rise as the convener of the aforementioned Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and thank the Government for taking what we said seriously. It was an entirely unintended consequence of some drafting, and I'm grateful they've tidied it up.
Many thanks. Minister, do you feel the need to respond? Thank you. In which case, the question is Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendment 10 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, already debated with Amendment 4. Dr. Simpson, do you wish to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. That then brings us to Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. And I ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Moved.
Many thanks. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. And ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Moved formally.
Many thanks. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are, in which case that ends consideration of amendments. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 11826 in the name of Maureen Watt on the Food Scotland Bill. Could members leaving the chamber please do so quietly? Could those members who wish to speak in this debate please press the request to speak buttons now? And I call on Maureen Watt to speak to and move the motion. Minister, maximum 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open the Stage 3 debate on the Food Scotland Bill. I would like to thank the Health and Sport Committee.
Order, please. There's far too much noise. We can't hear the Minister. Minister.
I would like to thank the Health and Sport Committee for its consideration of the bill and for its careful handling at Stage 2, as well as the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee for their very detailed scrutiny. I would like to thank the Bill team and my colleague Michael Matheson for doing the bulk of the work surrounding this bill. The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring people in Scotland live longer, healthier lives. Making sure that we eat a good, nutritious diet of safe food is vital to achieving that ambition. Foodborne diseases, for example, cost Scotland £140 million per year. More significantly, of the 130,000 consumers contracting foodborne diseases each year, around 2,000 will be hospitalised and around 50 will sadly die. Similarly, poor eating habits are one of the most significant causes of ill health in Scotland and a major factor in obesity. The Food Scotland Bill gives Scotland some of the levers we can use to tackle these issues. Firstly, the Bill creates Food Standards Scotland to be Scotland's independent food safety and standards body. We have already announced the appointment of Ross Finney as the chair designate. I met Mr Finney last week and will shortly announce the name of the other members. FFSS will comprise of 8 members, including the chair, as allowed for in the bill. I have noted concerns expressed earlier about the minimum numbers of members allowed for in the bill. I hope appointing a full complement of members now demonstrates the government's intention to maintain a broad membership for Food Standards Scotland. The FSS will be a non-ministerial body operating free from the influence of ministers. The board and chief executive will need sufficient space to prepare and develop their strategic thinking and build key relationships with partners. We have also already announced the appointment of the acting Food Standards Agency director, Jeff Ogle, as chief executive designate. I met with Mr. Ogle on Friday and is keen to make progress. Jeff is already assembling his executive team and working with staff in Aberdeen to be ready for FSS to take on its full range of functions on the 1st of April 2015. Food Standards Scotland's clear objectives as set out in the bill will be to protect the public from risks to health which may arise in connection with the consumption of food, improve the extent to which the public have diets conducive to good health, and protect the other interests of consumers in relation to food. To achieve these objectives, the Bill sets out clear functions: to develop and help others develop policies on food and animal feeding stuffs, to advise the Scottish Government, other authorities and the public on food and animal feeding stuffs, to keep the public and users of animal feeding stuffs advised to help them make informed decisions about food and feedstuffs, and to monitor the performance of enforcement authorities in enforcing food legislation. The Bill sets out specific duties and associated powers for the new body on acquiring and reviewing information through carrying out observations and inspections, monitoring developments, and carrying out commissioning or coordinating research. New food law provisions are the second lever we are introducing through the bill to tackle food issues in Scotland. These are designed to protect and improve public health and other interests of consumers by driving up hygiene standards and reducing the incidence of foodborne disease, providing safeguards against food standards incidents, such as the horsemeat food fraud, and strengthening and simplifying the penalties regime for breaches of food law. The bill provides powers to seize and detain food which does not comply with food information law. These powers will more closely align food information powers with existing food safety powers. Currently, if food is unsafe, it can be seized or detained. Where food is unsafe, courts must order destruction of the food. However, there are no such powers for food which is safe but does not comply with food information requirements. In light of the horsemeat food fraud incidents, the power to seize or detain food does not meet food information requirements in respect of labelling, for example, will help eliminate food fraud. Without such a power being available at the moment, a food business may still be able to pass on food which does not comply with food information law. The bill also provides for the creation of a statutory offence of failure to report breaches of food information law. Again, this will more closely align food standard requirements with the existing duty to report breaches of food safety legislation. Under the suggested arrangements, it would become an offence to fail to notify Food Standards Scotland if any person suspected that food did not comply with food information law. The bill provides the Scottish ministers with powers to introduce a statutory scheme which will, amongst other things, require the mandatory display of food businesses of inspection outcomes. This is intended to drive up food hygiene standards and reduce the incidence of foodborne disease. The bill will also streamline Scotland's food law enforcement regime by offering a range of new administrative sanctions so that offences will be dealt with more quickly and at less cost. This administrative sanction regime, comprising of compliance notices and fixed penalties, will give enforcement officers more flexibility to deal appropriately with food offences. The use of administrative penalty options will reduce the burden on the courts and reduce the costs of local authorities in respect of prosecuting through the court system. I would like to turn to some commitments given by my predecessor at stage two to consider issues raised in amendments that were not accepted by the committee. I would like to offer some reassurances on those commitments. I can confirm that, as with all public bodies, ministers will expect that as much of the business of Food Standards Scotland board meetings and committee meetings will be conducted in public. As a non-ministerial office, Food Standards Scotland will be operationally autonomous. However, to achieve transparency, Section 5 of the Bill requires Food Standards Scotland to set out in a statement how it will perform its functions. I will be responsible for signing that statement off and will have power to modify the statement if I consider it appropriate. This statutory statement will have to include specific operational matters ranging from how consumer interests will be safeguarded to how reports will be published and what business matters the board would not consider in public and why. This statement of performance of functions will be an important mechanism helping Food Standards Scotland build public trust. At stage two, my predecessor also committed to exploring the practicability of introducing a scheme to encourage food business operators to report the outcomes of their testing and sampling. The government has explored this further, and I can confirm that we will be taking this forward. Ministers already have legislative power to make regulations in this regard, and so no amendment is required to this bill. We must first concentrate on bedding Food Standards Scotland with its current objectives and functions. But during 2015, ministers will be expecting a public consultation on regulations to introduce a testing disclosure scheme. The details will be developed for consultation next year. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, this bill will ensure food safety is given the prominence it deserves in Scotland. By creating Food Standards Scotland and equipping it with the necessary functions and powers, it will be able to make expedient decisions focused on issues which specifically affect Scotland and to take action to improve the diet of the people of Scotland. I move that the Food Scotland Bill be passed.
Many thanks, Minister. I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We've had a food standards agency since 1999, but as part of a UK agency. It has been a success. It has acted on its own initiatives. Perhaps, for example, as I said in the debate at stage three on the standards for school meals, it's also acted more recently in terms of independent research on food fraud, which led the rest of the UK. But with the UK Tory Lib Dem coalition breaking up the UK agency, consideration of the future of the FSA Scotland was necessary, and Professor Scudamore's report in March 2012 strongly recommended an independent agency. This is a classic example of powers with a purpose, and Labour have backed the general principles of this bill from the outset. In what's become a standard Scottish approach, which seeks to ensure that experts and the public are fully engaged in any new bill, we've had two consultations and indeed two further reports following the horsemeat scandal, Scudamore reporting again on food and feed safety and Ray Jones on traceability, labelling, assurance schemes and provenance associated with the primary red meat production and processing. We've come a long way since the Swan report in the late 60s and its report on antibiotics in veterinary use. Yet the issue of chemicals in meat production is a matter of continuing concern. If the transatlantic trade bill is approved, then I believe we must ensure that US meat produced using growth hormones, for example, is controlled. And we need to look at that in terms of that particular treaty. Most of the evidence that the committee received supported a new independent agency, but some did argue that preservation of the status quo would ensure a consistency of approach, communication and advice across the UK, maintain good links to the EU and avoid duplication of effort. The committee, I think, quite rightly rejected this view. I believe that it's vital to Scotland's food production that we have an agency seen to be independent and able to make sure that Scotland's reputation for quality is fully protected. For example, our farmed salmon is the only salmon with the label rouge, making it a premium product. The new agency's powers are, as the Minister said, to be enhanced. My amendments had sought to reinforce the agency's powers on diet and nutrition, working, of course, in partnership with the Government and Health Protection Scotland, which will be important in tackling what I believe will emerge as the biggest challenge in public health going forward. Currently, tobacco is the main legacy we're tackling. Alcohol, of course, is important, and progress is being made with price control, availability restriction, and I hope support for many of the 10 elements in my private member's bill. We will continue to make progress on that. But obesity, currently standing at 27.8% of adults, threatens to reverse the gains in life expectancy over the last 20 years. When I started in medicine, the level of type 2 diabetes was at 1% of the population. It is now at 6% across the UK, over 250,000 people in Scotland. The agency will have to meet head-on food content, saturated fat, trans fat, salt, sugar and food density or calories. And this will mean challenging the current approach of the much of the BOGOF approach of retailers, as well as the food industry. To do this, I supported many of the amendments which one of the premier consumer bodies had as table in phase two. And I believe it's imperative that in the appointments to the board, there should be a powerful consumer interest, an employee director, as Unison has suggested, and there should be gender balance. Labour will seek and act if this agency fails to demonstrate sufficient power in the area of nutrition. The committee notes that it noted that its views it received to suggest that one of the roles of the agency should be to help grow food and drink industries in Scotland. But if it is to do so, it will need to make sure that its role as a regulator does remain paramount. We must never forget that the feeding of brain and spinal cord to cattle as a money-saving device resulted in BSE, which we have not, by the way, seen the end of. I have concerns about the use of antibiotics and growth hormone, as I've already mentioned. And we're only now beginning to emerge from an era of excessive additives. Agents for anti-caking, anti-foaming, bulking, food colouring, colour retention, emulsifiers, humectants to prevent drying out, preservatives, stabilisers, sweeteners, thickeners, all named within Europe as E numbers, are widespread and pervasive. One example of the challenge of additives currently is whether colourants and sodium benzoate contribute to increases in ADHD, hyperactivity, in children. There's been a significant controversy associated with the risks and benefits of food additives. Some artificial additives have been linked with cancer, digestive problems, neurological conditions, ADHD, as I've mentioned, heart disease and obesity. But the evidence is often still equivocal. Natural additives may also be harmful or be the cause of allergic reactions in certain individuals. One example of this is azo dyes, a sunset yellow, banned already in many Nordic countries. And the EU has the highest consumption of soft drinks which contain these dyes, and Scotland has the highest within the United Kingdom. So clarity on safety, if needed, is at all possible. Of course, this is mainly a matter for the European Food Standards Agency, who do set many of the regulations for us, quite rightly. And their expert scientific panel, which deals with food additives, the ANS panel, has started the process of reassessing all permitted food colours, 45 in total, including the 6 additives which the UK Food Standards Agency called for food manufacturers to voluntarily stop in 2009. These colourings, if removed, could produce significant challenges to some of our producers, including such brands as Iron Brew, Bars from Bars, though Bars already exports a Ponzo-free drink in the form of Iron Brew to Canada, which has actually banned the UK recipe. So it's not impossible for food producers to change production without having to wait for the final results of tests. The new agency will need to commission research, but it will need to do so. It will need a memorandum of understanding, both with the remnant FSA, and it will need to work closely, if not have an understanding, with the European FSA. My own view is that it must lead us in a transition to a simpler approach to food, a world in which a slightly misshapen carrot or apple is regarded as acceptable as the pre-packaged, tracer gas-filled products in supermarkets today, the packaging of which is neither biodegradable nor recyclable, and one where additives are minimised. It must rigorously apply the precautionary principle. Deputy Presiding Officer, there are many other issues which I don't have time to go into, but if I may say in conclusion that the hygiene aspect of this bill is critical. We still have one of the highest rates of E. coli 107, and this is a challenge, as will be new emerging bacteria or strains. The matter of LA training standards will be dealt with a little bit more by my colleague Rhoda Grant, and Claire Baker will also mention again the meat inspection, which we dealt with in stage one, which is a critical part of this bill. Deputy Presiding Officer, I could go on for some time, but my time is up. I therefore commend this bill to the Parliament.
Many thanks. And I now call on Nanette Millen. 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Food Scotland Bill has been welcomed by most of the people who responded to the Health and Sport Committee's call for evidence, and the relatively few amendments to it at stages 2 and 3 are indicative of the general approval of the measures it contains. As I said at stage one, at a time when most of us rely increasingly on processed food and ready-prepared meals, it is imperative that we can trust the safety and nutritional value of the food that we eat. It's also vital that we begin to tackle the very serious problem of obesity in Scotland. And so, given the changed remit of the Food Standards Agency south of the border and following the horse meat scandal, it's generally accepted that the time is right for Scotland to set up a new standalone body with wider powers than the FSA, which it replaces. FSS will bring together that body's existing public health protection role with the new objective on diet and nutrition, and it will also have powers in relation to labelled food and non-compliance with food law. To be effective in tackling the complexities of diet and nutrition in Scotland, the Food Standards Scotland will have to develop a strong leadership and coordinating role, and this can only be developed by negotiation after the new body is in place and if it's adequately resourced and works closely with the Scottish Government's scientific advisers. At stage one, the importance of the existing links between the advisory committees and the UK Food Standards Agency was highlighted, indicating that these committees will be able to pull together the significant ongoing work in the UK and across Europe and give advice through FSA to Food Standards Scotland as an independent body. This makes the memorandum of understanding between Food Standards Agency and FSS crucial to the success of the new body by setting out how the two will work together where appropriate and enable them to exchange data and research findings in all areas of mutual interest. I confess that I don't know if this MOU has yet been published. I know it was being drafted, and I'd appreciate an update from the Minister on its development. I'd also welcome a progress... Yes, I will.
Killer point.
Minister?
The Memorandum of Understanding with FSA and Europe is being prepared, and it will be one of the first things that will be signed off by the new board.
Dr. Milne.
I look forward to hearing about that in due course. I would also welcome a progress report on the Scottish Government's monitoring of the food hygiene information schemes in Northern Ireland and Wales, and an indication of when such a scheme might be set up in Scotland. Presiding Officer, the consumer organisation which, following some of the concerns expressed at stage one, has welcomed the plans agreed at stage two to enhance enforcement powers through FSS, working proactively with local authorities to drive up standards, and also the decision to allow the new agency to have improved access to food testing from retailers and manufacturers, which will allow action to be taken swiftly when and where food adulteration is detected, to protect consumers and other businesses who rely on the same supply chain. It's indeed concerning that which, just a few months ago in its mystery shopping activity, found evidence of adulteration and misrepresentation of foods in a number of takeaways and fish and chip shops right across the UK. And it goes without saying that constant vigilance is required concerning the contamination of chickens with the Campylobacter organism, described by Professor Hugh Pennington in evidence as the commonest cause of food poisoning today. A number of witnesses did comment on the board size, which at 3 plus the chairman they felt is too small. And I'm disappointed that Richard Simpson's amendment to increase the minimum number to 4 was defeated. I hope the Government's faith that the Board will always operate with enough expertise and be consumer-focused in all its work will be justified, and I hope the Government will monitor this going forward to ensure that the fears are unwarranted. And of course, I am pleased that the first Board will have 7 members, plus the Chairman, if I heard the Minister correctly. One important concern to the retail sector, which is as yet unresolved, is the absence of robust appeals mechanisms for both fixed penalty notices and compliance notices. The sector very much regrets that the Government wouldn't agree to setting out details of the appeals process and providing safeguards for retailers within the bill, and would like assurances from the Government that it will work with retailers on any further secondary legislation to ensure robust appeal systems for both FPNs and compliance notices. Both the Scottish Retail Consortium and the Scotch Whisky Association have offered to comment on or assist with the drafting of regulations and guidance which will accompany the bill, and I hope this offer will be taken up. I won't go into any detail about why retailers feel that the burden of proof for FPNs must be set beyond reasonable doubt, and that a robust appeal system is important to ensure they're based on the same level of evidence as is required under a criminal rather than civil penalty, because I know officials have been in talks with the retail sector about this as the bill has progressed through Parliament. Likewise, for compliance notices, where the lack of a strong appeal process could have very serious implications for the livelihoods of smaller producers. So I would ask the Minister to assure us that these concerns will be considered when any secondary legislation is under discussion, and that Government will explicitly consult organisations like the SRC and SWA, who have consistently stressed the importance of a clear and robust appeals process being available. Presiding Officer, if these residual concerns are addressed, and taking into account the pledges given by the Minister today, I think the Food Scotland Bill can result in a very effective piece of legislation which will ensure the interests of food health protection and nutritional support in Scotland. And I look forward to its implementation, assuming it's approved at decision time today, and to hearing of its activities as Food Standards Scotland develops in the months and years ahead.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of 4 minutes, please. Christian Allard, to be followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to speak today on the last stage of his very much welcome Food Bill for Scotland. Let me first put on record my sincere congratulations to our new Public Health Minister, the Member for Aberdeen South and North Kincardine, Maureen Watt. In the Stage 1 debate, I spoke a lot about the North East, and of course I recognise that the Public Health Minister has been promoting the North East of Scotland as the country's natural larder many times before me. I experienced about the food industry, how to support food producers in the North East and across Scotland will be a great help in a new role. I believe that this bill will help Scotland becoming a healthy nation and a good food nation. I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate our predecessor, Mr. Matheson, on the 2 senior appointments he announced to lead Food Standards Scotland. Ross Finney and Jeff Ogle will bring their own experiences in the food industry. I recently met Jeff Ogle in his office in Aberdeen, and I'm delighted with his 2 appointments. My meeting with Mr. Ogle, then acting director of Scotland's Food Standards Agency, was to get reassurance that food producers will get a fair deal from any changes that this bill will bring forward. The Health and Sport Committee visited one of those producers, a seafood producer based in Aberdeen, in the same street as Maureen Watt's office in Tory in Aberdeen. I know the Minister will be familiar with Joseph Robertson, the family company founded in 1892, the seafood company producing the best quality sea-to plate produce. Michael Robertson, the managing director, shared his concerns with the committee about possible increasing costs for food producers associated with this bill. I trust the new agency headed by Jeff Ogle to reassure the industry on this point. Scotland doesn't operate in a vacuum at home or abroad. Our Scottish producers have to be able to compete. This is why I believe that new labelling and regulations in Scotland must be accepted in the rest of the UK and in the EU, and if they are to be enforced. A simpler approach to food, said Dr. Simpson early on, and there is a need for clarity and transparency. President Officer, let me clarify a point. I made in October debating this bill. The committee reports a discussion with Michael Robertson, the managing director of Joseph Robertson, about inspections, and that local authority inspections were not as a high quality as the retailers own inspection. This is an important point, Presiding Officer, and this is why I ask Food Standards Scotland to show leadership on this. John Slay, the Chairman of Chief Officers of Environmental Health in Scotland, wrote to me and shared his members' concern, but I agreed with Michael Robertson's concerns. Let me reassure Mr. Slay that I do not consider major retailers above environment health inspectors, but Mr. Robertson has a point. The new agency has to be the benchmark for everyone dealing with food safety. Food producers, particularly small and medium food producers, cannot afford to spend the amount of money they are spending today to respond to the constant demands of major retailers. To protect the consumers, it is imperative that inspections are of the same quality across Scotland, and to protect the food producers, they are accepted by all major retailers. I agree with the Minister in rejecting amendments that would have increased the pressure on health inspectors or on local authorities who are funding them. I believe the new agency will have a prime role to play, and my plea to all members of this chamber, Presiding Officer, is to support our food industry and remind Scottish consumers to buy locally and to eat the best, the very best of healthy food, the Scottish food. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Claire Baker to be followed by Colin Keir.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to make a contribution to this afternoon's debate. The Parliament recently held a food and drink debate, and there is a growing recognition that the public health agenda and the food and drink sector need to be more closely aligned. The current Becoming a Good Food Nation consultation does indicate a different focus from the Scottish Government. It is attempting to tie together the debates on growing food as a strong section of our economy with how do we address our domestic food challenges at home, both in terms of income and knowledge, and that is to be welcomed. It can be challenging to work successfully across government, and the new Standards Scotland organisation, which will cover responsibilities in public health as well as regulation of the food sector, is an example of the need for closer working together, producing food policies across government portfolios which meaningfully relate to each other. And what are the challenges that are facing the new body? This afternoon confirms the creation of the new organisation, and with the chair, a board will soon be appointed, notwithstanding the debate we've already had on the makeup of the board. And the policy direction and the focus of the organisation will then be created. So the debate now moves on to what does the new body achieve? As a parliament, we've led public debates on tobacco and on alcohol. We need to now turn our attention to food. By 2030, we will be spending £3 billion tackling obesity if we continue to go the way we are going. And at a time when our overseas food export market will be having the potential to expand with the development of new emerging markets, we'll be fighting battles about food here at home. Alongside obesity, we have health issues associated with poor diet and food poverty. There needs to be a realignment in our diets, and this new body has a role to play here. And how do we have that debate? As part of the Good Food Nation consultation, the Government are proposing a food commission. Debate in Scotland around food can be difficult, and Richard Simpson has the tabloid scars to prove it whenever he talks about the soda tax. A commission could provide the space for a reasonable, evidence-based assessment and proposals. Can the Minister say how this will relate to the new Food Standards Body? And if the new Food Standards Body is to have a greater public health role, how will this coordinate with the work of the NHS to prevent duplication and ensure coordination? At the cross-party group in the Parliament a few weeks ago on food and drink, someone said it shouldn't be a good food nation, but a good diet nation. And at our debate in Parliament a few weeks ago, members took us on culinary tours of their constituencies with the focus is very much on pastries and pies and tablet. And we have to ask, you know, does it matter if we consume these products as long as they are part of a balanced diet? But are people clear? I'm very tight for time. But are people clear about what a balanced diet actually means? A focus on fad diets, even from the former First Minister, doesn't really change long-term habits and help build good health. The new body has a role to play in providing trusted information, and the government needs to support them to get the message out there. You know, there's going to be no coffee table or kitchen table book is going to be produced by the new body, which competes with those that can promise you the latest starlit figure if you drink maple syrup or whatever the latest fad is. But the government and all partner agencies have a responsibility to promote clear messages and do all that they can, working with producers and suppliers to support that. And we do in particular, I believe, need to look at child obesity, and the reasons for that are complex. However, there is a real lack of information out there for parents. Portion size, calorie levels, activity levels. I genuinely don't think there's enough access and information for parents to support them in these areas. And the advice there needs to be tailored, and it is different advice than what we give to adults. And, Presiding Officer, in the Stage 1 debate, I focused on the regulatory role of the organisation and their responsibility for meat inspection. And I'd like to say again that this must be robust and resourced. We've seen cuts both in terms of numbers and inspections, and we've also seen this at local authority level with environmental health officers. This will be a real challenge for the new organisation to reconcile how capacity can meet the demand there is to ensure food safety. But, Presiding Officer, the reputation of the food and drink sector in Scotland is strong, and this new organisation has an important role to play in keeping it that way.
Many thanks. And I now call Colin Keir before we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank my fellow members of the Health and Sport Committee for making this what was a very enjoyable and very interesting piece of legislation to work on. With, if I can call it, the demise of the FSA in England to a shell of what it basically was, this Parliament has got the opportunity to put in place an organisation and regime which the public and those within the food industry at all levels can have trust in, and I think that's incredibly important given some of the problems we've had over the past number of years. And with the recommendation of the Scudamore report accepted, the single body with a clear responsibility for all aspects over food safety and standards can be developed. And it's the ability to take on many of the problems that we face in this country, which has really been the most fascinating thing. The poor diet that we've faced over a number of years, we've identified, we know what the problems are. And I think Dr. Simpson's brought out a number of very good issues today in terms of the things that the Food Standards Scotland will have to be looking at in the future are very valid. And I very much welcome the Minister informing us of the size of the board. I think that is good news. I think it's the right size. I think it's going to be led by the right person. And I look forward to seeing how that expands within itself to become the force within the industry that we really do need, because trust is everything. We have a food and drinks industry in this country which is absolutely vital to our economy, and we cannot see it go downhill because of a lack of legislation, food fraud, and quite frankly some dangerous issues in relation to infectious disease and the likes. So aside from that, probably the most informative visit that we made was really up to Aberdeen, and Joseph Robertson and company has been mentioned here. We not only met with the management of Joseph Robertson's, who gave us an insight into the business aspects of the industry and how what their thoughts were. Obviously, they had some serious concerns about labelling issues, what had to go on, how do we maintain our links. At that time, prior to the referendum, there was perhaps some politics being mentioned here, but how we dealt with the ability to maintain research funding and the likes, as well as the legislation as it would be when it came through to the likes of transport, food identification, where some of these problems were arising. We think of the horse meat scandal in terms of the food fraud initiatives that have to be fought against, because we can see that internationally, this is not something that our FSS have to deal with just here in this country. We have to be international in outlook. I think the word was bugs with don'ts work within borders, something along those lines. So we have to be international in our outlook. And I just feel it's absolutely critical if our food industry is to maintain at the top itself at the top of the tree when it comes to being looked upon from the outside. Now, finally, I know we're running a little bit shy of time here, but finally, I'm delighted the way the bill at least helps local authority enforcement officers, because that really is a tough thing that they've had to be going through. Some of the fines that were handed out in the past didn't come anywhere close to the amount of profits that were made, and I think anything which helps local authority enforcement officers is to be welcomed, and I'll call it a day there. Thank you.
Many thanks. We now turn to closing speeches, and I call on Jackson Carlow. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I was at my local bakery a couple of weeks ago. Mrs. Carlow and I are quite partial to their potato scones. Other inferior potato scones are available, no doubt, elsewhere. But I was there during the lunch hour for the local school, and it was quite an eye-opener. One pupil came along and ordered a mutton pie and haggis in a roll, which was a combination I had hitherto not heard of, with sauce, tomato and brown, all of which was demolished in short order. And I realised that when we talk about the underpinning obesity issue, and one doesn't want to be po-faced about the occasional treat, I have had a mutton pie from time to time. I even like haggis. I've never had them combined together in a roll with sauce of both types. But I understand that, the responsibility that this Food Standards Scotland will have in terms of the Better Diet of Scotland is one it's very easy for us to be rather intellectual and highfalutin about, because in the same way as many other cultural issues that we as a parliament have tried to grapple with have found, these are very deep-seated, and it'll be quite a tall order, but nonetheless a necessary one over time if we are to significantly address what in the broader health portfolio we understand is now an emerging crisis for the health service, which when this parliament was founded we probably wouldn't have included on the agenda of issues that one had to take into account in preparing future legislation.
Minister,
as long as it's not for an alternative potato scone brand.
Absolutely not, but I'm sure the member would like to take the opportunity to disassociate himself with his colleague in Westminster, who said that the poor can't cook nowadays.
Jackson Carlow.
Oh, naturally I would. Of course, the Mary Berry skills of the average Scot are absolutely exemplary. I must say the announcement of Ross Finney's appointment had passed me by. I'd missed that. There were those of us on this side who thought the Deputy Prime Minister might have seen fit to ennoble Mr. Finney. He, however, saw talents some of us had not fully appreciated in other colleagues in this Parliament of the past. And Mr. Finney has now fortunately found favour with the government, who've given him a useful occupation. I thought he might have joined us in the gallery today, but the meter is not running yet, obviously. But nonetheless, I wish him every success in the responsibility. And he is a serious player, and I think will actually, with the experience he had, be a first-class appointment. And those basal tones which have been lost to us here and which used to revive debates at that late hour in the afternoon as they boomed forth will no doubt, I think, be well-founded there. I hope I'm not sounding too irreverent, because this is an important piece of legislation, but the very fact, as Nanette Milne said, that there have been so few amendments, I think underpins, in fact, the very broad cross-party consensus that there is to it. I just want to say one thing finally. In my years in the motor trade, we used to have customer satisfaction surveys, and it was interesting because people in the west of Scotland were never 100% satisfied with anything, but we had to phone them up and tell them that they were, because sums of money depended upon whether or not people were completely satisfied. It's always made me very suspicious of these surveys ever since. But I do bring that then to the subjectivity that will underpin fixed penalty notices. And I think it very important that in the secondary legislation that's forthcoming, there is a common standard and understanding as to how fixed penalty notices will be applied and the criteria that underpin them. And I hope in a very serious way the Minister will ensure that is the case, because many small businesses could find themselves very adversely affected if we find variable, subjective criteria being applied to underpin that. Nonetheless, I very much welcome this bill. I know the Minister will be grateful that it hasn't been the hardest bill that she's had to inherit and take forward, and we look forward to supporting it in a few minutes' time.
Many thanks. I note that Nanette Milne is missing from the chamber, and I respectfully remind members if they participated in a debate, they should be here for closing speeches. I call on Rhoda Grant, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to start by thanking committee members and indeed committee clerks and support staff for their help as we work through this bill in the Health and Sport Committee. I'd also like to also thank Joseph Robertson, the Food Standards Agency in Aberdeen, and indeed the other organisations there that hosted the committee visit to Aberdeen. It certainly made our job a lot easier seeing how this bill would impact in practice. It could have been a very dry and difficult bill to deal with, but when you saw actually how companies had to put food standards and indeed labelling into practice, it made it an awful lot easier for us to examine the bill. I'd also like to congratulate Ross Finney on his appointment as chair for Food Standards Scotland. I think that was a very welcome appointment, and I think everyone in the chamber has been happy to congratulate him on it and wish him all the best in his new role. We are supportive of the bill and recognise the need for it following up the breakup of the Food Standards Agency at the UK level. We also hope that it will provide a really robust regulatory regime that protects consumers. I think consumers' needs and protection has to be at the heart of everything Food Standards Scotland does. But those high standards not only protect consumers, but also help to promote our produce and indeed protect our producers, because it gives them the reputation, as many have mentioned earlier in the debate, that allows them then to sell their products not only in Scotland, but throughout the UK, Europe and beyond. Like others, I would ask the Minister to bring forward an appeal procedure against the fixed penalty notice. I think a number of speakers mentioned that, Nanette Milne and Jackson Carlow as well. I think it's really important that justice is seen to be done, it's seen to be fair. I think a lot of people were very keen on the fixed penalty notice as it cut through bureaucracy, time and cost, but it also needs to be fairly administered to make sure that if there is any errors that they can be picked up and people have a right to appeal against any judgment made. Can I also, as Richard Simpson said, I would turn to trading standards officers, and indeed an awful lot of the legislation and regulation will come from Food Standards Scotland. But actually making sure that works and inspecting and examining that comes from local government through trading standards officers, meat inspectors, food hygiene inspectors, and indeed environmental health officers. All of those have a vital role in protecting consumers and making sure that the work of Food Standards Scotland is carried out properly and indeed regulated at ground level. We see local government facing cuts, and the worry is that while Food Standards Scotland may put in the regime, that regime will not be properly policed at council level. So we'd look for some reassurance that will happen in order to protect consumers and producers alike.
Minister?
I thank the member for giving way. Can I reassure the minister that part of the Food Standards Scotland function will be training in that area? So hopefully we will gear up the people in local authorities so that they can do their job better.
Roger Grant.
I'm grateful of that intervention. Can I also now quickly turn to the public health role, which was touched on by Claire Baker? And I think it's really important that this role is there, although we have to see how it will be developed. And we're keen to see how it interacts with other people with a public health role, such as the NHS and the like. It's very important that we look at public health. Richard Simpson talked about the increase in type 2 diabetes, which is enormous and needs to be tackled. And Claire made the comment, should we be a good diet nation rather than a good food nation? Well, I would have to admit that I was one of the people that took the culinary tour of the Highlands and Islands during the food debate a couple of weeks ago. And I noticed that Jackson Carlow continued that today with his promoting tatty scones from his local bakers. But I think we need to, while promoting, I think, with all of what is good, and there's the old adage, a little of what you fancy does you good, I think we also need to look at how we do tackle obesity, and especially childhood obesity, and also the knowledge of nutrition. I think we get a lot of nutrition on packaging, but it's not always understood that a child's nutritional needs are quite different from an adult's nutritional needs, and we need to do more about promoting that and food labelling. And indeed, some of the food that is actually designed for children is loaded with sugar, which is not very good for them. So we need to look at how food is promoted and packaged. And I think labelling plays a really important role in that, and that will be part of the Food Standards Scotland's remit to make sure that food is labelled properly and I think gives the right advice. Yes, it has to be consistent with the rest of the United Kingdom, and it has to be in line with legislation from the European Union as well as for other markets, because we want our produce to be sold further afield. But food labelling is really important about advising people what they should eat, and indeed looking at things like imported foods from other parts of the world, that Richard Simpson talked about, antibiotics, additives and the like. I think we need to make sure that food labelling does all of that, but as well promotes our food. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think Food Standards Scotland will help us to continue to build on the excellence we have in the Scottish food industry. I hope it will protect consumers at its heart, but also promote excellence within our industry.
Many thanks. And I now call on Maureen Watt to wind up the debate. Minister, up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In closing this debate, I would like to thank the members for their contributions today. I welcome the breadth of support the Bill has received through all its parliamentary stages and the constructive contributions that members have made today. Can I say to Richard Simpson that I shared his concerns about TTIP, and I actually discussed it with officials before coming in to the chamber today. The EU Commission has repeatedly stated that consumer health and safety and environmental standards will not be lowered, and that, for example, there is no prospect of GM crops or hormone-treated beef being allowed into the EU. So I think we will keep watching that space to make sure that that doesn't happen. And in terms of an employee director on the board, ministers will ensure that employee representation arrangements will be in this statement of performance of functions which the FSS is required to bring forward. Can I say that on all aspects of the provenance of food and the additives to food that he mentioned, I completely agree with him, and that's why we need to encourage the use of good, wholesome food from local sources as far as possible. Can I say to Nanette Milne, on the hygiene information schemes, ministers will ask the FSF for detailed advice on introducing the scheme through regulations, probably in late 2015. And on the appeals for administrative sanctions, it is a legal requirement that all food law is fully consulted on, and I will give an assurance that the appeal mechanism for compliance notices will be consulted on. But having spoken with the industry, there is no appeal mechanism possible for the fixed penalties. Presiding Officer, this bill does offer us a chance to make a real difference in areas of significant concern to the public, food safety and healthy diets. Setting out a nutrition and diet objective for FSS on the face of the bill gives the body a more transparent and strategic role in this area. Having a clearer remit to give SSS impetus to lead partnerships with other public bodies to tackle specific food and diet issues. This clear remit will help clear up confusion over roles and responsibilities among partners. I'd like to remind members that we're not simply rebadging the Food Standards Agency in Scotland with this bill. As well as giving FSS a clearer and wider remit on diet and nutrition, we are safeguarding the link between food safety, nutrition and labelling here in Scotland. Food Standards Scotland will indeed take on all the functions currently exercised in Scotland by the Scottish Division of the UK-wide Food Standards Agency. The remit of the Scottish Division has for some years been wider than the remit south of the border. In 2010, the UK government removed responsibility for labelling and for nutrition policy from the English arm of the FSA. In Scotland, we maintained the link between those and food safety. The UK decision was subsequently seen to have been a factor that hindered the UK government's response to the horsemeat scandal in 2013. And the horsemeat scandal demonstrated the importance of having a single body with clear responsibility for all aspects of food safety and standards. It's also important to note that the bill also requires FSS to operate in a way that is proportionate, transparent and accountable, and to carry out good decision-making, which includes consulting people and making its decisions publicly available. This will help build a new relationship with consumers and is one example of how FSS will operate in a different way than FSA does at present. Another key new feature of the arrangements we're making in Scotland is on making Scottish research more joined up. The FSS will be taking a more involved role in coordinating all grant-funded research into food and diet carried out by Scottish research bodies such as the Rout and the James Hutton Institute. And I think Claire Baker, though she's not present at the moment, asked about the coordination of effort, and it is proposed that there'll be a coordination between NHS and the Food Standards Agency. And I think through its creation, we will be able to have better coordination with FSS, NHS and the Scottish Government. And I also agreed with Claire Baker that as a nation we have kind of lost our way on food portions, and in our house recently where we were replacing chipped dinner plates, and I made sure that they were replaced with smaller ones. We'll wait to see if it makes a difference. Linking this, the research will provide a much wider knowledge base and a greater ability to coordinate efforts and focus. However, we will not lose the links with the rest of the UK and Europe. The UK government and FSA have given written assurance on access to scientific advice and to representation in Europe for FSS. Knowledge sharing is, of course, two-way. There are areas of expertise in Scotland, for example, on shellfish and E. coli, which our colleagues in the rest of the UK want to tap into. I'd like to reflect now on some of the issues that we have considered today. I'd like to recap on the importance of Section 5 in the bill and the statement of performance of functions. As I said in the opening debate, part of the debate, Food Standards Scotland will be operationally autonomous. And so this statement will achieve transparency and hopefully build public confidence and trust. The statement is where we will find assurance on operational matters, such as the method of publication of reports. I would like to give a firm assurance that I will make certain the issues raised in the debate and as proposed in Stage 3 amendments will be considered carefully for inclusion in that statement of performance. And this will offer clarity on, hopefully, on a number of the issues that have been raised today. Presiding Officer, as this has been a very helpful contribution by members, I'd like to thank them for all their input throughout all the stages of the bill. as Jackson Carlow said, I have only picked it up at this stage three, and I'm glad that it's been a fairly uncontentious bill. But I hope it will be passed unanimously at decision time today.
Many thanks. That concludes the debate on the Food Scotland Bill, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead on end-of-year fish negotiations. Could I ask those members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please? And I call on Richard Lockhead to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, you have up to 13 minutes to do so, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you very much. And can I just say at the beginning that it doesn't really feel like a year since we last discussed the annual fisheries negotiations here in the Chamber. Time, of course, flies by when you're really busy, and 2014 has certainly been a busy year for Scotland. We've seen momentous and historic events, the likes of which we may not see again for some time, but hopefully not too long. But the fundamental significance of fishing to this country remains year in, year out. Our communities continue to depend on our fishermen, who often operate in treacherous conditions, conditions which make fishing one of the most dangerous industries in the whole land. That was brought home again this year, of course, with the loss of life from the Ocean Way accident, a horrible reminder that too many pay the ultimate price to bring food to our tables. In Scotland, our fisheries are varied and spread the length and breadth of our country, from small inshore vessels to the largest and most sophisticated offshore vessels. Of course, this same fleet of vessels is also supporting our vital onshore processing sector, handling and selling fabulous seafood the world over with an unrivalled reputation. So I pay tribute, as I'm sure we all do, to the resilience and spirit of this great industry and acknowledge its contribution to the social and economic well-being of many of our communities. And we are right now in the midst of end-year negotiations. Negotiations, by their very nature, cause much uncertainty, and the annual bun fights that we're used to now can act against sensible forward planning, all of which strengthen the government's resolve to secure the best possible outcomes for the industry in this year's annual negotiations that culminate at next week's Fisheries Council in Brussels. I am pleased, however, to note that we have started on a bright note with the gains achieved at the EU-Norway negotiations just last week. Indeed, for the first time in recent years, these talks were concluded in advance of the December Council negotiations, removing uncertainty over key North Sea quotas and access to Norwegian waters. There were, as you can imagine, some very intense negotiations around the total allowable catch for cod and haddock in particular. These two stocks are closely linked in the rich and diverse mixed fishery of the North Sea, where harsh limits on one stock could lead to the increased discarding of the other stock. And forcing more discards on the fleet in this way would send the wrong message as the sector moves towards mixed fishery plans and the landing obligations part of the discard bans, where common sense, flexibility and innovation will have to be our watchwords. I'm glad to say common sense did prevail, and after much discussion, the talks delivered a much-needed and scientifically justifiable 5% increase in North Sea cod against a backdrop of a proposed 20% cut. North Sea saithe and whiting were reduced in line with long-term management plans, though, just like haddock, we continue to secure an inward transfer from Norway of additional whiting to help mitigate that particular cut. Other elements were rolled over from last year in a package that was broadly welcomed by the industry in Scotland. Given that haddock was assessed this year for the first time as one whole northern stock, straddling both the North Sea and the waters in the west of Scotland, I'm also confident that in Brussels next week we shall be able to secure a significant increase in quota for the west of Scotland haddock stock. The negotiating season has now moved on to the EU Faro talks, which have just concluded today. This important bilateral agreement was reinstated in 2014, as many of you will recall, after a four-year pause and much angst, and it has now re-established critical access for our whitefish fleet to Faroese waters, which alone is worth over £3 million a year. The deal also provides much-needed flexibility through access to additional fishing grounds and the provision of an effort refuge from the cod recovery zone for many of our vessels. And I am pleased to confirm to the Chamber that we have managed to maintain the same level of whitefish quota, and there has been no increase in access for Faroese vessels. However, the quota the Faroese can fish has been reduced in line with the overall total allowable catch changes from nearly 47,000 tonnes to less than 40,000. And in negotiating these agreements, it's my job, of course, to balance the multiple needs across all sectors of the industry to secure the wider benefits for all of our fleets. And let's be clear, the share of access given to the Faroese did in fact reduce from 43% in 2010 to 30% in 2014, and today's agreement maintains that level. I can, however, assure the Chamber, because I know this has been of concern to many people, that our compliance teams have targeted the resources and expertise on monitoring these vessels, i.e. the Faroese vessels that fish some of their quota in Scottish waters. In the past year, we have carried out 29 inspections on 51 Faroese fishing trips, a close-on 60% inspection rate, which is a truly impressive level of scrutiny, especially considering the environment that our compliance vessels have to operate in at this time of year. So I do hope that these figures reassure our fleet. I also know that our fleet will benefit from the sustainable mackerel quotas for 2015 that have been agreed in the last few weeks, yielding a Scottish quota of just under 187,000 tonnes. And that agreement will provide stability as we look ahead to next year, aided by our successful calls to the European Commission for increased banking provisions for mackerel in response to the Russian trade sanctions. But we are now packing our bags for the annual test of endurance that is the December Fisheries Council in Brussels, when all these talks come together with the negotiation that has to take place next week for the internal European stocks. I am told that I am now the longest serving fisheries minister in the whole of Europe, and I'll, reflecting on my experience, never be convinced that this is a sensible way to do business in a sleep-deprived environment that's crammed over 2 days, as no doubt we'll experience early next week. And as expected, this year's scientific advice prevents what we always term as a mixed bag. However, it's fair to say that the overall picture is more positive than last year, with some welcome advice suggesting increases for key stocks, such as Northern Shelf and Rockall Haddock, Monkfish, Megrim and North Sea Nephrops. But it remains as disappointing as it is illogical that once again, of course, we have to go and expand energy fighting off proposed cuts in days at sea that our fishermen are able to fish. It's again frustrating that we're still having to struggle free of this outdated and flawed straitjacket imposed by the now discredited cod recovery plan. And that's why I was clear when I met Commissioner Vila last week in Brussels that the cod recovery plan is now well past its sell-by date and needs replaced urgently. I was encouraged by his willingness to listen, and I hope, of course, his willingness is translated into action soon. More generally, we shall protect our position where the advice on quotas is unclear and where we need to ensure that positive recommendations, such as we do have for Monkfish and West of Scotland Haddock, are actually implemented next week. And we shall fight hard to ensure that so-called data-limited stocks are not simply cut arbitrarily, but are looked at on a case-by-case basis and on the basis of the available evidence and using stock trends as indicators. I will also be pushing hard to establish the principle that where the science identifies a stock as being one and the same in adjoining areas, there should be an element of flexibility in how the quota may be fished across these areas. This would be available only where quotas held in both these areas, of course, to protect historic interests, but it would be key to reduce unnecessary discards and costs for our fleet. And Haddock and Saith both fall into that category this year. However, the wider policy context around December Council is different this year. Proposals from the Commission are now translating many of the strategic goals of the new Common Fisheries Policy. And the signs are that next year's talks, which will be establishing quotas for the first year of the demersal landing obligation in 2016 as part of the discard bans, will be much more difficult. And before then, we will reach a significant milestone in tackling the discarding of fish when the pelagic landing obligation comes into force on the 1st of January next year, just in a few weeks' time. Of course, that is only the first step. From 2016, the ban will begin to apply to our whitefish and nephrop fleets, and from 2019, it will extend to all quota species. We all know the Scottish Government supported action to tackle discards, as did many parties across this chamber, and of course the industry also supported action, because it's a no-brainer. Nobody wants to have to throw perfectly good fish back dead into the sea. It's not good for business, it's not good for our fish stocks and conservation, and it's certainly not good for consumers in an age of increasing food security issues. I know that Scottish fishermen, as well as the onshore sector, are worried about the landing obligation and the significant changes that it will bring to their day-to-day practices. We shouldn't underestimate the challenges they will have to face and the adaptation that will be required across our fleets. But it is therefore right and proper that we work as hard as we can at Scottish and European levels to ensure that the landing obligation is introduced responsibly and in a pragmatic way and in a manner that avoids delivering big shocks and that damages our fragile fishing communities. But it's just as important that comparable vessels, for instance, fishing alongside each other, all face or anticipate the same level of monitoring of their activities at the same time. So as we take forward these discard bans, and I make this point time and time again to my UK counterpart, we have to have a level playing field. But I will look to make sensible use of the flexibilities built into the regulations, and I will take a pragmatic approach to phasing in the new rules. I'm also clear that we can't continue with business as usual. I've already spoken about the need to develop 21st century fisheries management tools to deal with 21st century problems and issues, and we should not be bound by the current structure which was created back in the early 1980s. If fishermen are being asked to adapt, then fisheries managers must also likewise be prepared to adapt as well. In short, there's an onus on both managers and fishers to innovate and embrace change, balancing responsible fishing with the viability of our fleet. And that's certainly the message I'll be delivering in Brussels. It's time for us all to roll up our sleeves and step forward together to meet all of these challenges we are going to have to face. Presiding Officer, we also seem to face stiff challenges and difficult decisions at the end of year fisheries negotiations. We always face these difficult challenges. That's why at every negotiation, we should be able to create the best possible conditions to get the best possible deal for Scotland. Unfortunately, the constitutional settlement we have at the moment does prevent that. And unfortunately, the Smith Commission's recommendations barely move us forward as far as securing the future of our fisheries in this country is concerned. The one reference to a fisheries-related topic finally appears right at the end of the Smith Commission document with the proposal to review the current arrangements for raising seafood levies. This is an area which has long been frustrating for the Scottish Government because of the outdated and inflexible nature of the current levy arrangements. And we have to get that right if we want to promote Scotland's fantastic seafood and help the industry. And believe it or not, the current arrangements stem from the 1981 Fisheries Act, predating Scottish devolution by almost 20 years. As a relic of a bygone age, these arrangements continue to tie Scotland to the dysfunctional UK levy system that seeks vainly to do the impossible job of supporting every different industry north and south of the border, including importers from other countries, which are often, clearly, they're all in competition with each other. So we have to change that system. The Scottish people should have the ability to decide the extent to which Scotland may participate in UK levy arrangements with the freedom, in legislative and practical terms, to establish separate arrangements north of the border where we consider it's appropriate to do so. There is one other recommendation that is relevant to fisheries. The Smith report recommends that where there is a predominant Scottish interest and the lead UK minister does not attend, a Scottish minister should by default speak for the UK in the EU Council of Ministers. Well, that clearly applies to fisheries, and no doubt was a subtle reference to fisheries in the document. But of course, it's the least we should expect, and it should put an end to the ridiculous situation where I, as Scotland's fisheries minister, with 7 years' experience, have been forced to watch and sit in silence on the sidelines and watch as inexperienced UK ministers and even unelected lords represent the UK in important discussions affecting Scotland's fishing industry. This was the case last month when Lord Rupert Ponsonby de Molay had to be briefed on the most basic of issues at the vital negotiations. Can I just say, Deputy Presiding Officer, the decision to draft in an unelected Lord with no experience of the issues at stake was an arrogant and insensitive insult that took no account of the mood in post-referendum Scotland. We now need genuine commitments to allow the Scottish Minister to lead the development of the UK negotiating position as well as to lead for the UK when appropriate. And I don't just mean when the UK ministers can't make it or decide to leave for Eurostar or their flight home early. We were, of course, disappointed by the lack of reference in the Smith report to fisheries. In a quintessentially Scottish sector in which Scotland is predominant in the UK, we see Devomax as a no-brainer which makes clear and absolute sense for fisheries. It's therefore frankly baffling that this litmus test has not been passed by the Smith recommendations. But, Presiding Officer, hands tied or not, I will of course ensure that Scotland's priorities are always uppermost in the minds of UK ministers, and we will do our utmost to fight for Scotland's interests right across the board. What is never out of my mind is what all this means in the real world of our fishermen
really
and the women
close,
that work
please.
In the industry as well. What they can fish, where they can fish it, how much, and how much time they can even spend at sea. That's why we will continue to do our utmost to secure the best possible deal for this great and proud industry next week. Thank you.
Thanks. Very tight for time today. Now call on Claire Baker to speak to and move Amendment 11825.3 up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's almost a year since the new Common Fisheries Policy was introduced, but this forthcoming year is the year when really the force of the changes start to come into effect. We are starting to see changes in the end-of-year negotiations this debate is referring to. There is increasingly less horse trading and late-night negotiations. There is an attempt to increasingly take the politics and grandstanding out and rather increase the focus on delivering sustainable fisheries that support employment, communities and our food sector, while not damaging stocks or the marine environment. Conservation and stability of stocks can deliver long-term economic health for the whole industry, onshore and offshore, and we need continued commitment from the Scottish Government and the sector to deliver on that. Scotland's fishing sector employs in the region of 5,000 people in the catching sector, as well as supporting key employment in supportive sectors. Scotland has world-renowned produce, and although our produce is sent all around the world, we could do more here to support our home market. Although we are an island, we are not big consumers of seafood, and there could be greater promotion of seafood, as well as a greater commitment to local sourcing, and I hope for a positive outcome from the Good Food Nation consultation, which is ongoing at the moment. The industry has a significant base in Scotland, but it does operate throughout the UK with a common regulatory system and a UK network of harbours and fish processors. This has been reflected in some of the concerns raised by the SSF around the quota consultation, but I'll say a bit more about that later. Although the drama of previous years may be on the way out, the importance and complexity of the EU negotiations increase as they are not just about allocating effort, but they are also about changing the system in order to meet the environmental objectives of the Common Fisheries Policy. We are now nearing the end of the negotiations, and I support the Scottish Government's key objectives going into the negotiations and wish the Cabinet Secretary well in these final stages. We are looking to amend the motion today to focus on the key issues for the sector rather than sustain a debate about who represents the sector when we all have a common view anyway. I do have cabinet, sympathy with the Cabinet Secretary over recent decisions on who put forward the UK case, but going forward, our understanding of what's clearly appropriate may not always be the same as the Scottish Government's. Notwithstanding, I don't have much time.
Sure.
If the member has got sympathy with the Cabinet Secretary, why did you remove the part of the motion which said exactly that, that it would be great for the Cabinet Secretary to have the opportunity to lead on the talks?
Claire Baker.
My understanding of the Scottish Government motion is it doesn't refer to the particular incident and where I was supportive of the Government's concerns about who represented us at the EU negotiations. However, as we had during the referendum debate, I was pretty clear that I believe the UK's strong negotiating position is actually the best deal for Scottish fishermen. Notwithstanding the questionable decision of the UK Government to bring in at the last minute the Member of the House of Lords to represent UK interests, I do hope the Cabinet Secretary will work well with his UK colleagues in the interests of the Scottish sector, as we have seen in previous years. These are significant negotiations, and I want to see Scotland support decisions which aid the effective introduction of the landing obligation, achieve fishing at sustainable levels, and help to deliver good environmental status. This can be achieved while retaining a profitable fishing sector, but it will require effort and commitment from all partners. We need to keep an eye on the prize of a fishing sector, which is a future without compromising our marine environment. As the Cabinet Secretary outlined, the already agreed increase in North Sea cod and haddock tack for the next year is welcome, and that will help ease the introduction of the new CFP. The successful negotiation of inward transfers of haddock and whiting quota is also welcome, as scientific evidence suggests they are in good shape. Presiding Officer, last year in the debate, Labour's amendment to the fisheries debate called for a clear plan of action to introduce the discards ban. I hope I can be convinced today that that is in place and the Government is supporting the sector in the efforts that have to be made. We shouldn't forget why we are introducing a discard ban. Discarding fish was of bycatch or not high enough quality was a practice of fishing for many years, particularly as the financial incentive increased. It took a TV campaign and a public outcry to really mobilise the movement against this practice, and it was a practice whose time was up. This can be a good thing, which respects our seas, the natural resource which it gives us, and it can open up new opportunities for the sector. Scotland's been a fishing nation at the forefront of good practice, and we should recognise the commitment of much of our fleet to achieve this. It has taken investment and some tough decisions. I recognise the frustration there can be at the behaviour of other countries and the importance of the need for a level playing field. But the new CFP is a further challenge for our sector. The nature of Scottish fishing will make it very difficult to deliver a discard plan. We need to ensure we have robust plans in place to deliver. Last year, the Cabinet Secretary spoke about the need for the Commission to provide fishermen with additional quota to enable the landing of all fish caught, arguing that the Commission must give us the tools to put in place sensible and practical discards ban. And I wouldn't disagree with the need for greater flexibility. That is crucial. But we also need to see greater regional decision-making and planning, increasingly identifying and making best use of what is a shared quota and resource. But we also need to see a plan from the Scottish Government, a clear indication of the measures they expect to see introduced, as well as what checks and balances they will bring into the sector, to ensure that those who are fishing responsibly and working to meet the new standard can be rewarded. And if there are fleets that are struggling to change or who are resistant to change, that they are supported to adapt or compliance measures can be introduced. Of course, once we get to next year, there will be the huge challenges for our mixed fisheries. There will be huge difficulties. We don't have the right quota at the moment to achieve this, but there will be ways to make it easier. Scotland has been at the forefront of selective gears, but there is more we can do in this area. At present, too many vessels are not using identified selective gear. We need to consider spatial management measures if we are to focus on avoiding catching unwanted fish. We need investment in research and development, working and supporting our universities to develop innovative solutions. Of course, increased or changed quota is important, but we must also work hard to develop markets for the currently less popular species. The Scottish Government's own economic analysis identifies offsetting economic benefits. Introducing measures which will enable the landing and selling of all fish currently discarded, or increasing selectivity so no unwanted fish are caught in the first place, has the potential to add up to £200 million to the landed value by 2020. Yes, we do need more flexibility from the Commission, but that will only take us so far. This does mean changes for our fleets, but if we start planning now for the challenges ahead, actually deciding on and being clear about the measures that will need to be introduced and the expectation that they will need to be delivered, there will be rewards. By 2015, Scotland and its fleets must show they are doing all within their powers and abilities to fish at sustainable levels, delivering maximum sustainable yield. This must be achieved by 2020 at the latest. We need to develop a clear roadmap now that will set us on the right path for the next few years. And the emphasis is often seen as being on the restrictive measures, selectivity, temporal and spatial management, behaviour change. But we should also work out ways where we can reward the good guys, the fleets who are taking this responsibility seriously and delivering on the environmental objectives. The Scottish Government has consulted on quota allocation policy. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of concerns that this period of restriction has been problematic or detrimental for some of the UK operators within Scotland. It is also my understanding that there has so far been little evidence of quota that has been held speculatively or as an investment. However, the Scottish Government do make a case that it is Scotland's national asset, and I await the outcome of the Government's consultation. However, if we are to see changes, this could present the opportunity for the creation of a pool of quota, which could be used to recognise the effort being made by fleets to comply. If we could, it could be used to specifically reward vessels which are able to bring social and economic benefit to local communities, who are helping to support fishing communities, provide employment opportunities and support a local economy, as well as a vibrant offshore sector. Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. I now call on Jamie McGregor to speak to and move Amendment 11825.2. Mr McGregor, 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to take part in today's important debate on the subject of the annual EU fisheries negotiations, which commence on the 15th of December, the outcome of which is vitally important to Scotland's fishermen, the people who risk their lives to put fish on our tables,
it's also vitally important to the processors and the fishing communities around our coast. We agree with the Scottish Government that our Scottish vessels need to retain the number of days they go to sea, and cuts are simply not acceptable. We're encouraged that last week's EU-Norway talks saw an increase in quota allocations for a number of key stocks for Scottish fishermen, including cod, haddock and plaice. And I'm also encouraged by what the Cabinet Secretary has just told us about an increase coming, hopefully, in West Coast haddock. These increases are in line with scientific advice, and these stocks are in good health. And this is in large part due to the sacrifices our Scottish fleet has made over a long and difficult period of the cod recovery plan and the innovative and important conservation measures our vessels have adopted, which have been very significant and which have surpassed by far the efforts of any other EU fleet. Our demersal fleet has seen its vessel numbers decline by around 60% compared with what there were in the first term of this Parliament. This needs to be recognised by the EU in next week's talks. If further effort reduction is proposed, the Cabinet Secretary must ensure this burden falls on other EU states and not Scotland's fishermen, who have already done so much. Our Scottish fleet must now be able to enjoy some of the benefits after the pain of the last decade and a half or more. Fishermen and their representatives have asked me to highlight today a number of the key issues facing their sectors, and I'm most happy to do this. One of the key and most pressing and immediate issues facing our pelagic fishermen will obviously be the implementation of the discard ban or landing obligation in their sector from the start of 2015. And Scottish pelagic fishermen quite rightly want to ensure the level playing field for the control, monitoring and enforcement of this ban and make sure that's truly achieved across the pelagic boats of everyone fishing in EU waters, whether vessels from third countries or other member states. And I know the Cabinet Secretary agrees with this. The level playing field is really very vital to them. There is clearly also a huge amount of work to be done next year to prepare for introduction of the landing obligation for the demersal sector in 2016. Well, it will bring even greater challenges than in the pelagic sector. There are real concerns in the whitefish sector about the practical implications of this discard ban, and working out a usable scheme that doesn't penalise our whitefish boats must be a very big priority for next year. Bertie Armstrong of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation has described the whole process leading to the landing obligation laws as a shining beacon of dysfunction, which has the potential to do significant damage to the fishing industry and communities of Scotland. And I rather agree with the sensible suggestion in Tavish Scott's amendment that a phased approach must be considered. Now, the Scottish Pelagic Fishermen's Association, the Scottish Pelagic Processors Association, and the Shetland Fishermen's Association are all very clear that another priority for their industry is the need to achieve a fairer deal in terms of the EU Faroe Mackerel Fishery Quota Access Agreement, which currently is totally skewed in favour of the Faroes. Between 2007 and 2013, the Faroes never exceeded a mackerel catch of 8,771 tonnes in the EU, namely Scottish waters off Shetland. But in 2014, that catch was a massive 46,850 tonnes. The level of this mackerel access quota must be looked at. Why do the Faroes require a third of their quota to be fished off the Scottish coastline when the mackerel stock has become so much more abundant in their own waters? The current situation means they are benefiting hugely from catching mackerel in prime condition in our waters, while not one kilo of the EU's mackerel quota has been caught in the Faroese zone. The Nephrops fishery remains a very important and economically valuable one on the west coast of my region, and its associated jobs help underpin often fragile local communities. Now, I share the real concern of the Clyde Fishermen's Association about the proposal for a significant cut in catch in the Firth of Clyde functional unit, although I note with some relief there is a projected rise in the South Minch area. Nephrop's fishermen in the Clyde area want to know what measures Marine Scotland will take to reverse the trend. And the Clyde Fishermen's Association are urging them to look again at their proposals that the minimum Nephrop's tail size be raised from 35 millimetres to 46 millimetres and the total overall length from 70 millimetres to 85 millimetres. I also welcome the possible consultation on scallop fishing, which has been pushed for by the Clyde Fishermen's Association since 1995. In terms of my amendment to today's motion, I would just want to refer to previous comments made by Bertie Armstrong. I don't wish to be called arrogant.
I'm afraid you'll have to draw to a close, please.
I'll finish off then. The chief exec, who said that the industry was much less concerned about who sits in the seats and absolutely concerned in every detail about what is said and what is on the speaking note for the minister or his representative. And the cabinet secretary knows that the UK government has consistently and successfully worked with him and his officials.
Please.
I conclude by wishing him the best of luck.
Good. Thank you very much. Now call on Liam MacArthur to speak to and move Amendment 11825.1 in the name of Tavish Scott. Please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted, if a little surprised, to be speaking in this debate. The detonation of a weather bomb and the consequential disruption to flights has meant my colleague Tavish Scott is marooned still in Shetland. And I think, given the vital importance of the fishing industry to Shetland and of these negotiations to that industry, Tavish Scott's absence from this debate is a loss, but I know he'd want to extend his apologies to you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to the Cabinet Secretary and to colleagues for his absence. I was struck by the fact that almost one quarter of all fish landed in the UK was landed in Shetland. More fish was landed in Shetland in 2013 than in Wales, England and Northern Ireland put together. And while I'll not pretend that the figures in relation to my own constituency in Orkney match those for Shetland, it is nevertheless a sector that is vitally important both economically but also socially to the islands I represent. So these negotiations and those that coincide with them matter a great deal. This year, unlike last, most of the deal appears already to have been done. EU-Norway settled last week, so too the Faroese access agreements earlier today. And so according to the SFF, there won't be a lot to fight about next week in Brussels. Famous last words, perhaps, but as someone who bears the scars of the round-the-clock negotiations and middle-of-the-night compromise agreements from back in the day, I can certainly welcome that and concur with the Cabinet Secretary's description of previous processes as a bun fight. It's not to say, of course, that there will not be challenges in a sector so varied, having gone through so much change and operating in such an environment, one would expect nothing less. Perhaps one of the most obvious challenges referred to by colleagues already, certainly for the demersal fleet, is the implementation of the discard ban. Next month, the Scottish Government will implement a discard ban on the pelagic sector. A basic minimalist plan is in place, and with a clean fishery where mackerel and herring swim and are caught in midwater shoals, the discard ban is relatively straightforward in this respect. That cannot be said for Scotland's whitefish fleet. From January 2016, however, the industry has to live with a fishing practice which logic suggests is entirely correct and entirely desirable. Landing all fish rather than throwing valuable quota species over the side is absolutely right. But the devil is assuredly in the detail, as Richard Lockhead acknowledged. Landing everything caught at sea in a mixed fishery within the existing quota system is fraught with risks and poses potentially disastrous consequences for some of our demersal fleet. I recognise that Marine Scotland have changed their perspective on implementation. The hard line appears to have softened, and this is very much to be welcomed. But a discard ban for the whitefish fleet must be realistic. It should start not with four species, cod, saithe, haddock and whiting, but instead with just haddock. And once a comprehensive assessment has been made into the effectiveness of the ban on haddock and the financial consequences for the vessels are clear, then further steps can and should be taken. I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to accept that approach, working with the industry to deliver a ban that can work not just in principle but in practice, something I believe that is a shared objective with many of the environmental NGOs. At present, the consequences of a ban are simple. If quotas are not significantly increased, then boats will go out of business as they will run out of quota as they land all the fish in port. Cod is the obvious example. An increase in quota in a land-all policy also has implications for vessel design, operation and capacity. 3/4 of the Scottish fishing fleet is over 20 years old. Many are much older and need to be replaced. This is a problem nationwide, and I think the government should be looking to assist in vessel replacement by utilising the European Maritime Fishing Fund. The industry itself should be encouraged to look again at vessel design, new engine types and fuel mixes, as well as other innovations aimed at reducing carbon burn. I know that Marine Scotland have acknowledged that this issue must be addressed, and I certainly again welcome that, though perhaps the Fisheries Secretary can make clear where he stands. Turning to other issues, today in London, the Faroese access agreements have been finalised. The unfair deal that rewards Faro for illegal fishing of mackerel is sadly set to stay until 2019, and no one in the Scottish pelagic catching or processing sector thinks this is a good deal. These agreements are meant to be reciprocal, but there seems precious little gain for our fleet and our processors. Faro said their waters were teeming with mackerel. It is therefore puzzling that instead of fishing in their coastal waters, the entire Faroese pelagic fleet is fished right up to Scottish coastal limits. Imagine the outrage if the reverse was happening. There seems little upside for our pelagic and demersal sector in the reciprocal arrangements, and it's something the Cabinet Secretary may need to take forward. I'm running out of time. Maybe you can address it in your wind-up. Sorry. Turning finally to the last part of the government motion, the call for Mr Lockhead to lead the delegation, almost as much a part of the annual ritual as the December negotiations themselves. As I've said before, making sure the UK position reflects the priorities of the Scottish industry and then backs this up with UK votes is what matters most. Ensuring those positions are arrived at sensibly and reflect the relative importance of different parts of the sector is key. The Smith Agreement, despite what Mr Lockhead said, makes clear that Scottish ministers should lead the UK delegation. There needs to be agreement, of course, with the Welsh, English and Northern Irish on the UK negotiating position. But in many areas, notably in pelagic and whitefish stocks, the Scottish interest will and should be the predominant one. Should the UK government have sent an unelected Lord to the Fisheries Council instead of Richard Lockhead if he could have been there? No. But that is why the Smith Agreement recommends an intergovernment arrangement that works. A Scottish lead backed by UK votes. I hope the Scottish Government will back such an approach. After all, the SNP representatives sensibly endorsed that approach in signing the agreement. The fishing industry made crystal clear in the aftermath of the vote in favour of the UK that they expect both Scotland's governments to work collectively and collaboratively in the interests of the industry. Parliament should expect that to be the case today and, more importantly, next week in Brussels. I wish Richard Lockhead and his officials all the best in their endeavours and move the amendment in Tavish Scott's name.
Thank you. We are now even tighter for time. Up to 6 minutes, please, as we move to the open debate. Colin Stewart-Stevenson to be followed by Cara Hilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I came here in June 2001, my very first speech was on fisheries, appropriately. And in that speech, I harked back to the work of Alan McCartney, member of the European Parliament, in relation to localities management, because it was he who'd championed that change in approach, which we see a little of in the progress that's been made in European fisheries policy. And on that basis, I very much welcome Labour's call for greater flexibility and regionalisation in their amendment. I think that absolutely focuses on some important things. I do think the very least I can say is that all three opposition parties have been unwise in deleting what it says in the government motion about our fisheries minister, the most experienced in Europe, leading the UK delegation, and I quote, where it is clearly appropriate to do so. In other words, it's not seeking an absolute right, it's where it's appropriate to do so. And indeed, let's just consider the issues for fishermen in other parts of the UK besides Scotland. It helps them to have the most experienced minister at the table. So it's not about simply, as the Tory motion says, benefiting from the UK's negotiating strength in Europe, but the UK benefiting from the strength of experience that being led by a Scottish fisheries minister would bring to the table. Now, I don't know the member of the House of Lords who led the UK delegation. He may be a very excellent person. We only address the issue of his inexperience and his working on a very different brief. As far as my research could see, his sole parliamentary contact with fishing had been to answer three written questions on the same day in October 2013, and I rather guess, as a former minister, I might say this, that the civil servants wrote it rather than drew in the knowledge of the minister. But however, that's a matter we'll no doubt return to on another occasion. The Scottish Fishermen's Federation have provided us with a briefing. I very much welcome that. And it highlights the adverse interaction between old, unreformed, and as yet not abandoned legislation and the new schemes that are seeking to eliminate discards. And it's precisely that kind of area where I think an experienced fisheries minister will always sacrifice an inexperienced one. The pelagic fleet, we've heard of some of the difficulties that they face, less from biological factors, but much more fundamentally from political decisions vis-à-vis the relationship between the Faroes and the EU and, of course, the developing difficulties in relation to trade with Russia, which are creating difficulties for the industry. The SPPA also do point out that restrictive legislation from Tórshavn, which seems to be designed to distort the market, is adding burdens to our industry and seeing our fish caught in Scottish waters by Faroese boats being required, essentially, to be landed in the Faroes. And, of course, that probably actually isn't much in the interest of the Faroese fishermen, even, because it's restricting the market opportunities for them. But more fundamentally, it's potentially restricting the opportunities for our processing industry. Now, we've seen many years of sacrifice by our fishing industry. The number of boats has come down. That decline is more or less stabilised. And total allowable catches are going up this year, and that's very good news. And that's because of the sacrifices of our fishermen. But where we previously might have seen that quota used usefully to increase economically valuable landings, it's quite likely a lot of that will have to be used to be allocated to fish that might have been discarded. So it's not clear that we've got a system under the EU rules that is going to be of value to our fishermen to the extent that a better thought out fishing quota system would be. And of course, the catching sector is very important, but even bigger is the processing sector. Many people in processing, packaging and promoting our fish. In my constituency, it's thousands of people. I recently attended a sea fish presentation. I was very impressed by the interaction that those who retail our fish, either as wet fish or in our restaurants, have with Scotland, because we want to get more Scots eating this good quality product for their health, but also for the health of our industry. The SFF are welcoming what's happened in the negotiations with the EU and Norway this year. That's good. The SPPA much less happy about the Faroese tax position. But seeing cod quota rising, seeing haddock quota rising, is absolutely first class. Now, the price of fishing for the fishermen at sea is high. My very first constituency event in 2001 was to see a bravery award to a fisherman who in January went overboard near Greenland to fish out one of his colleagues. He said he was more frightened going up and speaking to the audience in the fisherman's mission at Peterhead than he was diving off the boat. Little he knows. The one's easy, the other one is difficult. Presiding officer, I just share my apologies with members here. A rather urgent matter will take me away and I won't be here necessarily for the next two speeches, but I will return for the closing speeches. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Cara Hilton to be followed by Rob Gibson. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in today's debate on an issue of great importance to the Scottish economy, to our fishermen and to our coastal communities. Across Scotland, many people's livelihoods are dependent on the fishing industry, and we need to ensure that this is protected not only by taking short-term actions, but by showing long-term vision for the sector too. Protecting our environment and resources by ensuring that fishing is sustainable, and protecting our fishing industry by ensuring that it can be profitable both now and in the future, and that it's able to reach out to new entrants. As colleagues have already referred to, 2015 is likely to be a turning point for the Scottish and European fishing sectors, with the first phase of the landing obligation coming into effect on the 1st of January. This represents a huge change and a challenge for the fishing industry, and in theory this should mean that ultimately all catch will be landed and counted against quotas. As Claire Baker has already highlighted, this is quite a groundbreaking change, and it's a change that came about thanks to huge public pressure, with Hugh Fearnley Whittingstall's award-winning Fish Fight campaign gaining more than 850,000 supporters, united in the call to end the crazy system where millions of healthy and edible fish are thrown back into the sea after they've been caught due to the bizarre way that EU fishing quotas are managed. Very few campaigns succeed in changing EU law, but Fish Fight certainly captured the public imagination, changing the way we think about and eat our fish. The effective implementation of the discard ban is now absolutely crucial, and that's why Scottish Labour's amendment today calls on the Scottish Government to set out a clear plan of action to ensure that the ban is both implemented effectively and sufficiently monitored. The Scottish Fishermen's Federation and others have expressed some concern that the European legal arrangements may not be in place on time, and this does create uncertainties for fleets during the transition period, which needs to be addressed and managed. Colleagues have also referred to the particular challenges that exist in relation to whitefish. The change will become effective from 2016. And in the briefing for today's debate, the RSPB and WWF highlight the need to promote more uptake of the selective gear in fishing vessels and spatial management systems to avoid the catching of unwanted fish. They warn that at the moment, half of the demersal fleet are not yet using the identified selective gear. So we do need a clear action plan from the Scottish Government and how it will work with the industry to meet these challenges. While clearly change will be difficult for some fleets, the RSPB and WWF highlight that there are also longer-term financial opportunities. It's estimated that eliminating discards from Scottish vessels, either by landing and selling all fish, or by increasing selectivity so that no unwanted fish are caught in the first place, has the potential to add up to £200 million to the landed value of these fish by 2020. So sustainable fishing will hopefully make financial sense as well as environmental sense. And this is crucial given the importance of the fishing industry to our economy, with the livelihoods of thousands of Scots in our coastal communities dependent on fishing continuing to thrive. Across Scotland, an estimated 5,000 people are directly employed in fishing, and as many as 48,000 jobs in Scotland are dependent on the sector. The fish processing sector, which Stuart Stevenson referred to, is especially vital to our economy, yet this can be a vulnerable sector too, and we need more action to support it and to improve its sustainability. Key to this must be promoting our fantastic produce here in Scotland to the domestic markets. We're all aware that fish is healthy and that we need to be eating more of it, but generally a lot of us find it complicated to cook and are reluctant to try new types of fish. So much more needs to be done to promote fish as a sustainable, affordable, healthy and easy option. The Scottish Government's Good Food Nation strategy offers this opportunity, and I hope that we'll see this as the outcome of the consultation. Campaigns too, like Sainsbury's Switch the Fish initiative, are crucial in changing customer behaviour, and similar campaigns by other retailers need to be encouraged to persuade people to eat a wider range of fish and not just the big five. Highlighting the choices we make every day and the way they can secure a sustainable future for our fish industry in Scotland. Schools too have got a big role to play in explaining the importance of fish in the diet and creating opportunities for children to give different fish a try. When I was writing this speech this morning, I had a look at my children's school dinner menu, and while Harry Ramsden's battered haddock was a frequent option, that seemed to be the full extent of what was on offer, and I think this needs to be looked at. Given the issues too that people have got about cooking fish, practical lessons in school would be a real benefit too. And I think our children need to have a greater appreciation too of where their food is from, and in the case of fish, how it's caught and processed from start to finish. And this will ensure that in future they can make good choices, live healthier lifestyles, become more educated shoppers and consumers in future. I share the Cabinet Secretary's concern about, and Stuart Stevenson's concern about the fishing industry being a dangerous industry. It's estimated that 1 in 1,000 fishermen die each year as a result of their job, and that's over 100 times the rate for the average job in Scotland. Many more are injured in the course of their work. I understand too that there's been little improvement in this fatal accident rate in the Scottish fishing industry in the last 30 years. Given that fatal accident rates in almost every other occupation have fallen sharply during the same time, this suggests that commercial fishing has become progressively more hazardous over time. And therefore, I'd welcome any comments from the Cabinet Secretary on what actions the Scottish Government is taking to make fish a safer career. That will obviously make it more appealing to new entrants and be a real benefit to families and to our coastal communities. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we're now nearing the end of the fish negotiations, and it's vital that the Scottish Government does whatever it can to ensure that Scotland feels the full benefits of the reformed common fisheries policy, that the discard ban is implemented as quickly as possible, and that those fleets who are adapting to the challenges are rewarded, ensuring a vibrant and sustainable future for our fishing industry and for the jobs, families and communities it sustains.
Many thanks. I now call on Rob Gibson to be followed by Christian Allard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP Scottish Government fights hard for Scottish fish processors, producers and the whole sector in Brussels, and they will do next week. So it's important for us at this annual review of fishing to think about what could strengthen Scotland's position to back our ministers. And as a member of the Devolution Further Powers Committee, having had a chance to look at some of the Smith Commission proposals, I would suggest that we need to make sure that the respect agenda, which was talked about earlier this year, is something that is applied to the way in which Scottish ministers are engaged in representing our country when their appropriate stance would help to strengthen that approach in Europe. So, presuming that a devolved administration minister can speak on behalf of the UK at a meeting of the Council of Ministers, according to an agreed UK negotiating line where the devolved administration minister holds the predominant policy interest across the UK and where the relevant lead UK government ministers are unable to attend all or part of the meeting, is a suggestion from the Scottish Government about how to achieve this. But, you know, it's a remarkable about the way in which some people have commented on the need for that to happen all the time. And in particular, I refer to the kinds of funds which we get at the present time through the EU Fisheries Fund. SPICE has shown us that on 2007 to 2013, on euro per tonne of average fish production, Scotland's bottom amongst the countries that have fishing fleets. On euro per tonne on average fish catch, Scotland is second bottom. On euro per average gross tonnage of fishing fleet, Scotland is second bottom. Scotland's fishing fleet has been badly let down by not having a Scottish minister lead the negotiations in Europe to make sure that those funds apply to our area with all its difficulties and with all the wild nature of the seas around us. So I would like to suggest that maybe it would be a good idea to ask why the Conservatives have been prepared to say that, in fact, as Jamie McGregor did on the 12th of June this year, that it would be wrong for fishing communities in Scotland to receive more money from the European Fisheries Fund, and suggesting that the Scottish fishing industry is too successful to require extra support. And indeed, that Ian Duncan, the recently elected Tory MEP, was criticised quite rightly for claiming that Scotland's fishing industry should not receive vital funding. He said the funds should go to those places which are struggling. The Scottish industry is not struggling. That at the end of May this year. Presiding Officer, it's amazing to me that a similar stance was taken by the Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation in a discussion on the radio about the said Lord Ponsonby de Molly. Bertie Armstrong said, well, all the priorities are spread across the UK. And of course, again, this sounds slightly odd coming from Scottish fishing leaders. No, Scottish fishing leader, because other Scottish fishing leaders were appalled at remarks which came out from this gentleman, who then went on to say that it's important to think about the sea prawns for the Northern Ireland fleet and the Celtic Sea haddock for men in the South West. Yes, indeed, our Scottish fishing leaders should be out there fighting for Scottish fishermen, and we need to get off the bottom rungs of the ladder in the European Fisheries Fund and much more. Now, I'd like to turn at this time to the review of the Good Food Nation, which has been mentioned by Stuart Stevenson, but more detail by Cara Hilton and indeed by Claire Baker. That's a long-term strategy of trying to get people to eat better. And the disconnectedness which people have hinted at is one of the key themes in the unfinished business of this strategy, which aims to get this sorted by 2025. Many people in Scotland are disconnected from their food. There are considerable efforts being made in schools and elsewhere to engage with children. Nevertheless, many people of all ages in Scotland remain profoundly unaware of how and where the food they eat and its ingredients are produced. But at the same time, on the upside, there's an upsurge in the demand for local food. This is part of an encouraging way to produce and sell locally grown food in all its shapes and sizes around our country. So that means that we've got to make sure that the inshore fleet in particular, which has much more local markets, and I count Scrabster, Kinlochbervie, Lochinver, Ullapool, 174 under-10-metre boats, 45 over-10-metre, as producers of much of the food that should be being sold in Scotland and around our country. So it's up to our government and other agencies to procure fish to a greater extent and to make sure that our school children, our patients in hospitals and prisoners, etc., as well as the wider public, have a chance to eat the best of Scottish. I support the motion in the name of the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. I now call on Christian Allard to be followed by Graham Pearson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me first declare for anyone today who hears me speaking for the first time that this French-born MSP has worked for the last 30 years in the Scottish fishing industry. And I'm honoured to represent the many fishing committees in the North East, from Fraserburgh to Peterhead, and since May 2013. We still have to wait for the outcome of the EU negotiations, but yes, like other members said before me, we can agree that talks are getting a lot better than they did the past few years. However, the main reason why negotiations have been easier this year is that we have settled the mackerel dispute. I said it at the time, we in Scotland need to recognise that our fishing communities have nothing to gain to let such dispute in the pelagic sector to run for years. The whitefish industry suffered as a result, an industry that needs all our support. There is a lesson to learn here. Less dispute and more partnership with our neighbours is required. Let's make sure that the pelagic bilateral talks between the EU and the Faroe Islands in Ireland this week are not going to spill over to the whitefish industry. This part, Jamie McGregor did not speak about. I share the concern of the chair of the Scottish Pelagic Processors Association, Ian McFadden, who I met first more than 30 years ago, and I thank him for his briefing. The tone of the negotiations, Presiding Officer, must show our will to negotiate with others. The tone used by some when talking about the challenges faced by the Scottish fishing industry is a tone to drive an anti-European agenda, one that should be left to members of UKIP. The Scottish fishing industry deserves better. So what is left of the fishing industry in other parts of the UK. I shall take this opportunity to repeat that this Cabinet Secretary is the most experienced fishing minister in Europe, one who should be sitting at the main table and speaking for the people who represents the fishing communities across Scotland. Some disagree, Presiding Officer, and I shall explain why their arguments don't hold water. Last month, the National Federation of Fishermen's Organisations, the representative body for fishermen in England, Wales, Northern Ireland and the Channel Islands, the NFFO, said its members' interests were in danger of being sacrificed to placate the clamour of more powers for Scotland. That was the reaction after reading the submission of the Scottish Government to the Smith Commission. They didn't need to worry. The suggestion from the Scottish Government is still on the back burner and very much has been diluted. I understand the hostility towards further devolution for Scotland. It is a direct result of the democratic deficit experienced by the industry in England. Unlike other parts of the UK, the English industry does not have a parliament or devolved body that can stand up for its own interests. We know the UK Parliament is not looking out for the fishing industry, particularly in Scotland, with the Scottish fleet once been described as expendable. I was surprised to, like Rob Gibson said earlier on, presiding officer, to hear that our own Scottish Fishermen's Federation chief executive seemed to agree with the NFFO. Bertie Armstrong said on BBC Radio Scotland on the 10th of November, is Richard Lockhead the best man to state these priorities? He's certainly the best man, providing he talks to us carefully as the priorities are agreed. He kept on and said, he's certainly the best man to talk about Scottish fishing. But is he the best man to talk about the fishing for Ulstermen or people in the southwest? I think not, was the answer of the chief executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation to his own question. And am I the only one in the chamber thinking that this sounds odd coming from someone representing the Scottish fishing industry's interests? Let's remind this chamber what happened last month. Westminster sent to speak in crucial EU talks for the Scottish fishing industry a Conservative Lord, Lord de Molay, an unelected Lord with no previous experience whatsoever in fishing. Is he the best man to talk about fishing for Ulstermen or people in the South West? I think not, Presiding Officer. We can all agree that it is never appropriate for an unelected Lord who knows nothing about fishing to speak for our fishermen. Ulstermen or not, the UK government proves again that it couldn't care less about our fishing communities. Fishing is never on Westminster's radar. The Scottish government is doing a lot for fishing and wants to do more. Fishing leaders need to support the call for this cabinet secretary to sit in front of seat and need to be four square behind him.
Go ahead. Briefly. Please, Claire Baker.
The member might be interested to know that Westminster is debating fisheries negotiations on Thursday this week.
I don't know, but I'll be very pleased to hear about it, and I hope that at Westminster we will not do what the three political parties have done, is taking out a very important part of the motion of the Cabinet Secretary, saying that the Cabinet Secretary, the Fishing Minister in Scotland, should have a part to play at the talks, particularly that it's in the Smith Commission. Common sense and flexibility should be the two principles when it comes to fishing negotiations, is what we hear all the time. And this year, I would like to make a call for the Cabinet Secretary to address a particular problem of closures of skates and rare fisheries in the northeast and west of Scotland. Let's make sure that lessons have been learned to avoid a repeat of what the unfortunate situation that happened this year. Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call on Graham Pearson to be followed by Dave Thompson. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate today. I'm also grateful for the range of briefings that I received before the debate and ones that I found very informative from the various organisations. Jamie McGregor acknowledged the pain and the sacrifice that have been made over the decades by those in the industry as a revolution attached to the industry, and they reorganised to deal with modern demands. And Stuart Stevenson, in his contribution, indicated the outcomes from those previous works and the way in which the industry is now fit for purpose in delivering on behalf of the United Kingdom. He also recorded that our Cabinet Secretary is the longest-serving Fisheries Minister in Europe, and I'm unsure if to congratulate him on the honour or to commiserate and wonder where has he gone wrong in his endeavours. Nevertheless, I would say it's most unfortunate that the Tory Lib Dem coalition at UK level decided to allocate responsibility for negotiations last month in Brussels to Lord de Molay, instead of relying on the evident expertise of our own Cabinet Secretary to represent UK interests. I would hope, however, that Mr Lockhead would reflect that perhaps the frenetic promotion of nationalism over the past few years has had some influence in decisions in this matter, and that his contribution in the new post-referendum era will be more welcomed at UK level and more constructive in the way that it is received. I'm happy to.
Thanks very much for the member to take an intervention. You know, I will not call Law Smith a nationalist, and he has, in his own commission, put out that the current concordat of the coordination of European Union policies issues needs to be improved. And does the member agree that it needs to be improved, and that that improvement is exactly what the Cabinet Secretary has asked today and what the Labour Party took out of the motion?
Pearson?
I think as the debate goes on through the afternoon, the nuances in the debate will bring out where our loyalty should lie in regard to the fishing industry, which is the most important part of what we debate today, rather than the language of the various motions. I think that the developing conflict involving the Western world and Russia, as it affects our fishing industry, reflects the importance of our discussions today. And the Commission's agreement enabling the 25% rollover in allocated catches from 2014-15 helps the Scottish fishing industry to cope with the import embargoes which have been instigated by Mr Putin and have been estimated as costing the wider food industry up to £89 million in the year. Fisheries operates in Scotland as a Cinderella industry across most of our communities. We enjoy the produce that they produce, but seldom consider how it's brought to our table and the pressures faced by those in the industry when providing first-class fish, fresh and safe for consumption. The policies, imperatives and ensuring industry needs are complex but inescapable. We have a growing world population, now in excess of 9 billion, all who need our food. An industry that has geared up to supplying the needs with modern boats, modern technologies and professional crews able to deliver catches at an industrial level. But there's a pressure to conserve stocks of valuable fish to provide food for future generations and an industry with a vision for sustainability. The Cabinet Secretary must, in my view, ensure that he continues his support for those brave crews who go out into the sea on our behalf. The interests, the increase in quotas are optimistic for the end of year agreements, and one hopes that those agreements will be fulfilled. The Cabinet Secretary must ensure that the new rules regarding discards are made clear to the industry and to the public alike, because discards are ill understood by the general population and seem to be an area of conflict over previous years. The Cabinet Secretary should also contribute to the continued development of new technologies, net designs, crew education, to ensure a mutual understanding is maintained in regard to the competing demands arising from conservation needs and consumer demands. He must also ensure that there's no repeat of the blackfish scandal that affected the industry only in the last few years. And I would hope that he would give us an assurance that he'll liaise with the Justice Secretary accordingly to ensure that the good name of Scottish fishing is maintained in the years ahead. At the same time, a liaison with his opposite number in education would do no harm to ensure our young people across Scotland have a better understanding of the fish produced in our very seas and will have a better understanding of that delivery than I did in my time. Scottish industry accounts for approximately 60% of the total UK catch and around 7.5% of the EU total volume, please, according to European Commission 2014. This is too important an industry for us not to take a careful care of the future, and I rely on the Cabinet Secretary to give us that assurance. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. Now call on Dave Thompson, after which we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is indeed an important debate and precedes the implementation in January of what many believe will be the final nail in the coffin of Scottish fishing, the discards ban. The Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Richard Lochhead, has done the best he could for our fishermen over many years now, most of the time, well, all of the time, with his hands tied behind his back by the Westminster government and because of a dysfunctional EU common fisheries policy. Baron de Mauley has been mentioned. Now, far be it for me to criticise him, but such was the confidence of the Scottish Fishermen's Organisation in him that they described him as clueless and went on to say, and I quote, they doubted he had spent much time on Eton's playing fields discussing black scabbards and the discards ban. I couldn't have put it better myself. What is illustrated here, of course, yet again, is that the UK government treat us with contempt and cannot be replied upon in crucial EU negotiations where Scottish fisheries are concerned. Of course, we all had a chance to untie the Cabinet Secretary's hands on September the 18th, but unfortunately we did not take it. We loosened the knots, but full freedom is yet to come for the Cabinet Secretary and the rest of us. We, your SNP government, have done all we could to protect our fishermen and fishing communities, but we have not been able to do so as much as we would have liked. This has not been because of a lack of will, but because of a lack of power to do so. I was born and brought up in the great fishing town of Lossiemouth, whose harbour was packed with fishing boats when I was a boy, and whose school delivered qualifications in navigation. Such was the demand for fishermen in Lossiemouth. Indeed, one of my first jobs at the age of 12 was heading and tailing prawns after school in the fish shed belonging to Seagull, a well-known local firm. I also led my first strike there at the age of 14, when us prawn boys walked out after a dispute over pay. Many of my family went to sea, and some still do, and of course we have suffered our share of tragedy, like all those in fishing communities. I've been to sea a number of times in the Murray Firth, the Minch, off the Butt of Lewis, but only for a day at a time. Some, like Sandy Patience of the Fishermen's Association Limited, have spent their lives there. I can also lay claim to have written the SNP's fishing policy in the 70s, when we responded to the opposition claim at that time that SNP stood for still no policies. Therefore, as someone who has great empathy with our fishing industry, I found it particularly galling to listen to Bertie Armstrong, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, backing Better Together and the UK in the referendum. A UK which sold out our fishermen in 1971 when the Tories signed us up for Europe. A UK which cares so little about fishing that it sends a junior, inexperienced Tory to represent us in Brussels. And a UK which is currently reneging, or trying to as best it can, on its vow to give extensive powers to this Parliament. Now, presumably, Armstrong spoke on behalf of the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, but I'm sure he did not speak for many of our fishing communities, or possibly even many of his own members. These members need to decide whether they have the right leadership, I would suggest. Armstrong, however, is not totally uncritical of the UK and has described the discard ban as a shining beacon of dysfunction. But he still insists in his briefing for today's debate that there is a bright future for Scottish fishing. Does he really believe that, or is he wearing his rose-tinted UK specs again? I hope he is right, but it does not look good unless we get the discards ban right. Compared to Armstrong, the Fishermen's Association Limited recent submission to the Smith Commission backs my view that Scotland is not being served well by the UK in EU fishing negotiations. They state that because the Department for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, DEFRA, holds the power in all EU and UK fisheries matters, it puts Scotland in a marginalised position, which results in decisions being taken which are not in the best interest of Scotland. FAL maintain that Scotland should be able to lead the UK in the EU on fisheries, especially given the importance of fishing to the Scottish economy. Of course, FAL quite rightly point to the unmitigated disaster the common fisheries policy has been to the Scottish and indeed the UK fishing industry. Their chairman, Sandy Patience of Auch, whom I know well, told the Scottish Discard Steering Group on the 27th of November that FAL has no desire to be further involved in the discards ban. He describes it as unworkable and impractical and fears it will crush what is left of the industry. I fear he is right, and although I support the Cabinet Secretary in his efforts to implement this flawed policy, I would ask him to be ready to argue for its abandonment. If he does not get a suitable agreement next week in these, as the motion says, pivotal negotiations, or it does not work for the pelagic fleet next year. If this means defying Brussels on this important issue, then so be it. As a lossy loon for a fishing toon myself, I'm with Auch Loon Sandy Patience and FAL as they strive to protect their way of life, heritage and birthright.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Liam MacArthur, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we've just heard an example there, not just of referendum deniers, but I think the personal attack on Bertie Armstrong was outrageous. I think the call for him to be ousted is in marked contrast to SNP members that were lining up both to praise him but also to quote him in fisheries debates from 2007. Onwards. But by and large, I think this has been the usual generally consensual debate with issues of concern being raised across the chamber. All have acknowledged the importance of the sector, not just to island communities like the one I represent or coastal communities, but far beyond that. I think it was a point made by Cara Hilton in her contribution, also alluded to by Stuart Stevenson in pointing up the importance of the processing sector. That importance is economic, yes, but I think the resonance of the fishing sector goes far beyond that in the Scottish psyches, and it's an importance that can't be measured simply in pounds and pence or indeed even in jobs. The negotiations, obviously being the focus of the debate this afternoon, against the backdrop of, I think, generally encouraging conclusions to the negotiations between EU and Norway last week. I think the agreement with Faroe earlier today was perhaps the best of a bad job, but that is definitely an agreement that still grates with many in the pelagic sector. There is great anger still within the industry. But as we look ahead to next week, I think there's no doubting the fact that those negotiations look more straightforward than they have been in the past. I think that was a point acknowledged by the Minister. I think he made a very valid point about the extreme opening negotiating positions. That means an awful lot of effort is expended trying to roll back from a position that nobody realistically expects to be held, but nevertheless seems to be the modus operandi of the Commission. Jamie McGregor, I think, also, and one or two others, point to the threat of further effort controls. And again, I very much welcome Richard Lockhead's strong emphasis on the need to hold the line there. This is an area where our industry has already conceded a great deal, and I think it's time for others to perhaps shoulder more of that responsibility. Turning to, I think, one of the key themes of the debate, the discard ban. Again, as I indicated in my opening remarks, I think this poses generally far fewer problems for a pelagics fishery that is far cleaner, and I think going forward from next year that should be borne out. But the discard ban, while right in principle, needs to be got right in practice. And I think in that respect, as we look to the demersal fishery and the implementation of a ban from 2016, we're not yet, I think, remotely close to where we need to be, and the potential for that being significantly more problematic, I think, is acknowledged all round. I was interested by Cara Hilton's reference to the fish fight, and there's no doubting that this was a campaign that captured the public imagination. What I would perhaps question is whether it captured the complexity of the issue. And I think for those that are then charged with the responsibility of developing policy on the back of that, yes, it brought to the attention an issue that nobody disputed needed addressing. But I think it perhaps created an overly simplistic impression of what needed to be done to resolve it. I think RSPB in their briefing and pointing up the importance of the use of selective gear and other technical measures and rolling that out more widely across the fleet, I think it's something that is featured in fisheries debates dating back as long as I can remember, and I think there's still more that needs to be done there. I think the final, a brief intervention, yeah.
Just to highlight to the member that surely without that campaign, this issue was much less likely to be addressed in as timely a fashion as it was because of the consumer pressure.
Liam McArthur.
Yeah, as I say, I mean, I don't want to diminish the importance of campaigns such as that, but I think there is a risk sometimes that what they do is paint in primary colours and leave policymakers who are then charged with the responsibility of responding with a difficult tax to match those expectations to the complexity of the issue. Turning finally, I think, to the political issue that ran through today's debate, that of who leads the delegation. As again I said at the start of the debate, I think the Smith Agreement does provide us a basis, a sensible basis, for implementing a set of arrangements that better reflect the needs of the industry, better reflect the political aspirations, I think, of the public. I think the Scottish ministerial lead, there is no doubt, as I think Stuart Stevenson indicated, that delegation benefits from the experience, not just of the minister, but of the officials that are supporting him or her. But by the same token, obviously, Scottish ministers benefit from having the weight of UK votes and influence behind them. We have not got that right. I think the example that was cited is a perfect illustration of it. But nevertheless, I think the government motion, and this was perhaps something that Graham Pearson was alluding to, the government motion talks in very reasonable tones. I think some of the rhetoric that was used during this debate in order to make that point was considerably less reasonable. And I think the respect agenda that Rob Gibson was pointing to is a two-way street.
Could you draw to a close, please?
In concluding, can I again wish the Cabinet Secretary the best of luck in the negotiations next week? Whatever seat he or his officials are sitting at, I hope he continues to have influence, brings to bear the experience and expertise that he has, and that he will continue to promote Scotland's interests in those negotiations. Thank you.
Much. Now, Colin Alex Ferguson, up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Ferguson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It makes a pleasant change to be holding this annual debate in an atmosphere of some, dare I say, optimism about the future prospects for Scotland's fishing industry. Normally, this debate is full of doom and gloom, with grim forecasts of further cuts in quotas and days at sea, and worrying prophecies of the further demise of our fishing fleet. So what a credit it is to that fleet and to all those who work within the sector that the Scottish Fishermen's Federation is able to conclude its briefing note to us with this statement. There is one overarching fact, and that is that the fish stocks of concern to the Scottish industry are, with few exceptions, either in robust health or heading encouragingly in that direction. It goes on, there are some very significant challenges to be met. Principal among them is the discard ban. But if these can be overcome and we look outwards to greater fishing opportunity, then rather than inwards towards protectionism, then there is surely a bright future for Scottish sea fishing. Now, greater fishing opportunity is not a phrase that we've heard a lot of in recent years. And our hope, whatever continuing challenges remain, must be that that air of optimism continues, and that it's not long before discussions on greater fishing opportunities and presumably a consequential expansion of our fleet becomes the norm in these debates rather than the exception. But as the debate has shown, there are still significant challenges to be overcome as we embark on what everybody agrees is a turning point in fisheries management in Scotland. What enables us to call it that is the first phase of the discard ban, which comes into force, as many have pointed out, on the 1st of January for the pelagic fleet and a year later for the demersal fleet. And while it's clear that the ban will impose more difficulties for the demersal fleet than the pelagic, it has to be a matter of considerable concern that, as Bertie Armstrong has put it, and Jamie McGregor drew attention to, the whole process leading to the landing obligation laws is a shining beacon of dysfunction. Now, while that probably shouldn't come as a massive surprise, given that it is the EU we're talking about, it does open up the possibility that different countries, different member states, may interpret the regulations in different ways, and in doing so, fail to create the level playing field that I think we're all agreed is so essential to the success of this policy. And if anyone is tempted to think that this is not much of an issue, I did note that both the RSPB and WWF briefing noted, and I quote, "sympathy for a fleet which faces potential uncertainties as to the legality of landing fish in the new year, should the necessary European legal arrangements not be in place." And that same briefing, however, does also note the potential benefits of successful implementation of the landing obligations. Eliminating discards, either by landing and selling fish that are currently discarded or by maximising the use of selective fishing gear, could be worth, as I think Claire Baker pointed out, up to £200 million to that sector between now and 2020. And surely that must be worth the effort. But it also, I think, requires the Scottish Government to do everything within its power to encourage innovative and proven selective fishing gear to be used. And I have to say we're also highly supportive of the plea to phase in the new regime for whitefish stocks that the industry has made. And I was pleased to hear that the Cabinet Secretary appears to be sympathetic to that approach as well. Another major concern that has also been mentioned has to be the outcome of the EU Faroe Islands Agreement and its impact on our pelagic fleet, although I do note what the Cabinet Secretary said about this morning's agreement. It does seem extraordinary that one-third of the Faroese quota is caught off the Scottish coastline, and it all will have been caught, while, as Ian Gatt of the Pelagic Fishermen's Association has said, not a kilo of the EU's mackerel quota has been caught in the Faroese zone. And he goes on to ask what seems like a very reasonable question. As the Faroe Islands were granted a hugely increased mackerel share this year on the basis that mackerel is more abundant in their waters, why do they then need to fish a third of their quota in Scottish waters? That has to be a good question, Presiding Officer. And if this morning's agreement has done anything to address what seems to be a glaring imbalance that is leaving our fishermen increasingly disadvantaged in the global market, well, that is all well and good. But I will be interested to see if the fishermen's view of that agreement is as positive as the Cabinet Secretary's. Liam MacArthur's contribution would suggest that it perhaps is not. Presiding Officer, let me conclude by referring to the amendments that have been tabled. It is noticeable that without any collusion, all three opposition parties have opted to try to amend the motion from the second use of the phrase "and supports." In other words, they have sought to remove the slightly political aspect of the motion that the government wants to include and will no doubt succeed in including. Stuart Stevenson suggested we were unwise to remove that section. Christian Allard's been becoming positively animated about it, but I do think that the Cabinet Secretary's opening speech and some of the contribution of his backbenchers has shown that we were right to do so. I don't have time. I'm very sorry, Michelle. Forgive me. For our part, we will do everything we can to ensure that the relationship between the UK fisheries ministers and ours is a healthy one, and that the vital importance of Scottish fishing fleet to the UK fisheries sector is properly recognised. But the road to success is surely through working closely together, as has often been the case in the past, to achieve mutual benefit across the UK, rather than simply continuing the pre-referendum jargon that failed to persuade the Scottish voters to vote for independence just 2 months ago. So I hope the Cabinet Secretary will not be tempted to go down that route in his closing statement. The Smith Commission has recognised the need for a different relationship.
Please.
The UK government has already responded by inviting Angela Constance to represent the UK at a vital EU meeting. So let me suggest, in a spirit of consensus, that the Cabinet Secretary accepts the amendments and proves that we can all work together for the betterment of Scottish fishing industry. That is what we voted for on the 18th of September.
Well done. Thank you very much. I now call on Claudia Beamish. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been an optimistic debate, not least Alex Ferguson's last sense of optimism about the future negotiations. It is almost a year, and it certainly doesn't seem like that since we were in this chamber with a similar debate for the end-of-year fisheries negotiations. And last year, before the Cabinet Secretary was due to travel to Brussels for the negotiations, we were awaiting the formal introduction of these new policies, which were intended to do away with many of the structural problems and the bad practices. And we must be hopeful that the policies underpinning the new CFP will solve many of these issues. I want us to consider just how important the industry is to us and how much the people who are involved with this industry, certainly those that go to sea, do face challenges and dangers. And I think we should all take time to reflect on this and on the task faced by those who go to sea here and across the globe. And I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will make some comment on Cara Hilton's concerns about health and safety and how the fatalities have not been improving over the last 30 years, indeed worsening. I'm sure members will agree that the widely criticised practice of discarding which will lead to bans, is absolutely essential and will vastly improve the overall health of our shared fisheries. As always, we must be careful to balance economic interest with sustainability to ensure that a fit-for-purpose plan is in place, and we will listen very carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary is saying in his closing remarks in relation to this, and that is stressed in our amendment. I was, however, concerned to read that the Scottish Fishermen's Federation have reservations over the effectiveness of the legislation underpinning the discard ban or landing obligation. And according to the SFF, there is confusion, as we've heard in this debate, around the legislation, making it unlikely the fleet and compliance agencies will be made aware of the precise legislation in time for the implementation. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can say a bit more about that. As we approach the final round of negotiations over the fishing effort, it is, of course, important that all species are fished sustainably. Members from all sides of the chamber have discussed the quota allocations for various species in some detail, and I won't go into that detail here, although it was good to hear of the discussions that have been had already by the Cabinet Secretary on the discredited cod recovery plan, and we wish him well with those negotiations. It is important to note that the SFF are broadly happy with the outcome of the bilateral negotiations between the EU and Norway on the haddock and cod stocks. So this suggests a good deal may well have been struck. And both the industry and environmental NGOs are in agreement, which about the maximum sustainable yield. So that is, again, a note of optimism that we can hold on to. I also note today's agreement confirmed by the Cabinet Secretary with the EU and Faroe deal, but it appears from what has been said by Liam MacArthur as well that we need to be listening carefully to the fishing industry on this, although I did note what the Cabinet Secretary said about there being more tonnage available to the Scottish fleets in this agreement. And Graham Pearson has highlighted concerns about the Russian ban and the loss to our economy because of that, and I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can comment on that at all as well. I want to focus somewhat on regionalisation, because with the aim of sustainable but economically viable fisheries, it is important that the European fisheries are managed in a regionalised way. And with the agreement for the new common fisheries policy showing that the top-down, one-size-fits-all approach to fisheries management is frankly pathetically simplistic. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary will be able to say a little bit more about how he sees the regionalisation going forward. Last year, I highlighted organisations such as Baltfish and the Scheveningen Group, if I pronounce that rightly, which covers the North Sea member states, and wonder whether he has involvement in these. I want to turn my remarks to this year's Rural Affairs and Environment budget now, and point out that the research budget generally and the marine and fisheries budgets are set to decline in real terms unless there are changes here. This is particularly concerning in view of the fact that the National Performance Framework Marine Environment Indicator is worsening. Is it plausible for the Scottish Government to place the blame for this largely on the mackerel dispute, which was resolved earlier this year, when it is the whole marine ecosystem which is being analysed for this indicator? And I seek reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary that he is confident that these funding cuts are indeed acceptable in these circumstances. Rod Gibson made a plea for the purchase of local fish, and Cara Hilton has pointed out that the Scottish Government is currently consulting on the Good Food Nation. Many have highlighted in this and previous debates the importance of being adventurous with our fish diet. Now we hear only last week of research published in the British Medical Journal that women who eat a Mediterranean-style diet may live longer than those who don't, according to this new study, which has looked at one marker of ageing. Ah, no, I'm afraid I can't remember last minute, just about anyway. And this includes fresh fish, of course. So this is another way in which we can be sure that we encourage people to, particularly women indeed, to put fish in their diet. And I think Graham Pearson's question of the Cabinet Secretary about liaison with his education counterpart on fish is fundamental for the future if we are to educate future generations of consumers about what type of fish they buy. I do indeed wish the Cabinet Secretary well in the negotiations, and I'm sure his expertise will be greatly valued within the UK delegation, which will bring strength by having more clout than it would if it was only Scottish, in my view, although I know we disagree on that. And I hope that alongside his UK colleagues, he will be able to deliver an agreement that benefits the industry and consumers in Scotland and the UK as a whole, as well as our shared marine environment and, of course, future generations. Thank you.
Thanks. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary, you have until 5:30, please.
Thank you. As I approach my 8th consecutive annual fishing negotiations, I very much welcome the comments and reflections from members from across the Chamber on some of the big issues facing our fishing communities and wider seafood sectors. I think it is quite a strange atmosphere just now in our Scottish fishing industry. There's a mixture of optimism and also deep anxiety at the same time. I think these factors have also been reflected in many people's contribution. There is some degree of optimism, however, and even the fishing news, the newspaper, which I'm sure all members subscribe to, has been relatively optimistic in the last couple of weeks as well. And I was reading in relation to the situation in Shetland and Peterhead. Firstly, on the 5th of December, Fishing News said that local whitefish fishermen landing prime whitefish caught within 20 to 30 miles of Shetland from trips of 16 to 72 hours unanimously voiced optimistic comments about the future of their industry. And of course, we've also seen high landings at other key ports in Scotland, particularly Peterhead, where it said on the 5th of December, last week's achievement was only the second time that an annual total of 1 million boxes of whitefish has been achieved at Peterhead since 2000, when nearly 1,030,000 boxes were landed. So there is a degree of optimism in the fishing industry at the moment, but of course, against a backdrop of anxiety.
Ian MacArthur.
I should declare an interest as the son of the cartoonist of the fishing, news. But will he agree with me that the optimism within the industry will not be helped by government backbenchers launching the sort of attack on fishermen's leaders that we've heard from David Thompson earlier in this debate? And will he distance himself from those comments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, what I actually think is that the industry's optimism will not be helped by the Labour, Conservative and Liberal Democratic parties not giving the power to their Scottish ministers to make sure we address some of these deep anxieties the fleet do have. But let's not forget that we are talking about seafood in this debate. We're talking about the product that's landed by our fishermen who go to sea in all kinds of conditions and atrocious weather from time to time, which of course means very dangerous conditions. But that seafood is very, very valuable to Scotland's economy. It made a huge contribution to Scotland's fantastic export records, particularly in terms of food, obviously, where seafood accounts for around 50% of food exports. And we should be very, very grateful to our fishermen for going out in all kinds of conditions. That food, of course, graces some of the best restaurant tables in the whole of Europe, and even in places like Orkney, where I happened to be last week enjoying some fantastic local seafood, albeit I think it was actually imported from faraway Shetland, the food I was enjoying last week. But that provides an enormous contribution to Scotland's economy, the seafood that's landed by our fishing industry. And it's something hopefully we can celebrate more than ever before next year, 2015, the year of food and drink. And let's make sure that healthy, nutritious seafood is at the heart of the promotion of that sector. And of course, in our schools as well. And I think Cara Hilton and others mentioned the importance of building seafood into food education and introducing it to our children. And that is why the Scottish Government funds the Seafood in Schools initiative, which is becoming ever more successful. It is a dangerous occupation, however, and I think also some members asked me to respond to what we're doing to promote a culture of safety at sea within the industry, which is crucially important, and we know that from recent tragic events, and it's something we can never devote enough time to, and we have to keep doing that. I can tell the Chamber, of course, that the Scottish Fishermen's Federation have been working with the Scottish Government to make sure that personal flotation devices are made available to every fisherman in Scotland that requests one, and of course funding for that. Over £300,000 came from the European Fisheries Fund, and the rest of the funding was contributed by the fishing industry itself. To protect our seafood, to protect the jobs in Scotland we all want to safeguard, we do need sustainable fish stocks in our waters. It's also about protecting a valuable food resource. Graham Pearson and others mentioned the fact the world population is expanding and therefore we have to protect this valuable food resource. That is one reason why we do have to make sure we have the right policies in place at European level and Scottish level. But stocks are improving, and it is down to the massive sacrifice of Scotland's fishing industry, particularly over the last 10 years or so, where many good men have been forced to leave the industry because of crazy regulations from time to time. But as a result of the sacrifices of the industry, stocks are recovering, and also the optimistic outlook for 2015 and beyond hopefully is something we can realise. But if you look at the proposals for the fishing negotiations this year, in terms of the Commission's proposals for some of the stocks that will be discussed next week, we have monkfish being proposed for a 20% increase, nephrops, that's the prawns, for a 15% increase in the North Sea, a rollover for the valuable megrim stock, and in terms of the West Coast, we have a 113% increase proposed by the Commission for rockall haddock, and a 20% increase for monkfish, and a 1% increase for the valuable megrim stock in the West Coast as well. And looking at what was agreed last week in terms of the North Sea stocks, we've seen a 5% increase for North Sea cod, a 15% increase for North Sea haddock, and a 15% increase for plaice as well. There have been some reductions for other stocks, but our key valuable stocks are seeing increases. And of course, there is a reduction in stocks as part of long-term management plans, which we all support. So we have to recognise that these stocks and these recommendations are in good health because of the sacrifice of our fleet. And the fleet don't have to wait for discard bans. Our fleet have been undertaking a lot of effort using selective gear and other measures to reduce discards. The whitefish fleet in the North Sea have reduced discards since 2007, the first year when I became minister, by 64%. The prawn fleet have reduced discards of cod, haddock and whiting in the North Sea by a further 93%. And in the West Coast, we've seen some reductions as well, albeit there are still some ongoing serious problems in the West Coast of Scotland that have to be addressed. But now we have the new Common Fisheries Policy. We have two key objectives that result from that. Firstly, we have to achieve sustainable stocks by 2015 where possible, and definitely by 2020. That will be challenging for some of our stocks, albeit 8 of our 12 key stocks are already being fished at sustainable levels. And secondly, of course, something that's dominated this debate is the objective of banning discards between 2015 and 2019. And I fully accept this gives Scotland enormous challenges given the mixed fishery we have in Scottish waters. We have many different species swimming together, and if you run out of quota of one stock, it means that you have problems in catching the other stocks for which you do have quota, because you have to land your fish, you're not allowed to discard it. And that is why we need Europe to make sure we modernise the regulations. We'll be fighting for that next week and throughout 2015. It also means we have to continue to work with our fleet here in Scotland. There are plans in place. We have a Scottish discard steering group. We're working with the onshore sector, the fish processors, as well as the fleet itself, to look at what this means for the fleet and what new measures can be adopted in Scottish waters. But my message to the European Commission is we can't use 1980s legislation to deliver 21st century solutions for discard bans. I remember going to the Council in 2007, the first time I went to a council, and raising the issue of discards in European waters and how it was unacceptable and it was ecological vandalism. There was very little interest from other member states or the UK government back in 2007 to tackling discards. So we've travelled a long way from 2007 to where we are today in 2014. We now are going to tackle discards once and for all, and that is in the interest of fisheries conservation, the interest of Scottish jobs and the wider fishing industry. So 2015 is
going to be, if you could bring your remarks to a close,
a big year for the industry in Scotland. But you know, I have to say that I am now shadowing my fifth UK fishing minister. No doubt it will soon be the sixth UK fishing minister after May's UK elections. Therefore, it is absolutely ridiculous that the UK government choose to send an unelected lord to represent Scotland's fishermen at the Council of Ministers as opposed to experienced Scottish ministers. That does show absolute contempt for the people of Scotland, and most importantly in this case, absolute contempt for our fishing communities and the thousands of people whose livelihoods depend upon that sector. But in closing, Presiding Officer, I can just say if we can get the big decisions right in 2015, we will have the opportunity to allow our fleet to sail in calmer waters. So whilst there is some disagreement over some of the issues, and the government will be opposing the amendments in the opposition parties, I hope that is one objective we can all rally around. Let's get the best deal for Scotland's fishing communities next week in Brussels, and let's allow our fleet to sail into calmer waters.
That concludes the debate on end-of-year fish negotiations. We now move to the next item of business, which is decision time. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 11826, in the name of Maureen Watt, on the Food Scotland Bill, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to, and the Food Scotland Bill is passed. Can I remind members that in relation to the debate on end-of-year fish negotiations, if the amendment in the name of Claire Baker is agreed to, the amendments in the name of Jamie McGregor and Tavish Scott fall. The next question then is that amendment number 11825.3 in the name of Claire Baker, which seeks to amend motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead on end-of-year fish negotiations be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 11825.3 in the name of Claire Baker is as follows. Yes, 47. No, 63. There were no abstentions. And the amendment is therefore disagreed to. If the amendment in the name of Jamie McGregor is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Tavish Scott falls. The next question then is amendment number 11825.2 in the name of Jamie McGregor, which seeks to amend motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead on end-of-year fish negotiations be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 11825.2 in the name of Jimmy McGregor is as follows. Yes, 45. No, 65. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question then is amendment number 11825.1 in the name of Tavish Scott, which seeks to amend motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead on end-of-year fish negotiations be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 11825.1 in the name of Tavish Scott is as follows. Yes, 16. No, 62. There were 32 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question then is that motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead on end-of-year fish negotiations be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. Thank you. The result of the vote on motion number 11825 in the name of Richard Lockhead is as follows. Yes, 62. No, 0. There were 48 abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.